This is our final move. You are the Allies' last hope. The Nazis won't go down without a fight. You have one mission. Drink all of Hitler's blood.
Hello, we are live. Welcome to Blackwater D&D, where good friends tell better stories. We are thrilled tonight to be in partnership with the good folks over at Rowan, Rook and Decard in support of their incredible Kickstarter, Eat the Reich, and showcase this fantastic game in its first ever actual play online. If you're new with us tonight, thank you so much for coming by. We are Blackwater D&D. We're an actual play channel here with our main campaign on Monday nights, and we feature indie games and different systems on Wednesdays. This is the part two of a three-part series, and I can't wait to jump into it. You don't really need to have seen the first part. All you need to know is that we're a bunch of vampires killing Nazis tonight. That's basically what we are going to be doing. The Kickstarter ended last week, but keep your eyes peeled for late pledging and purchasing, and just go and support other Rowan, Rook, and Decard projects. You can type exclamation point vamp in the chat if you want to check out what the Kickstarter was like and all that kind of good stuff. So before we jump into the game, I'd like to first acknowledge that we are streaming tonight from the traditional, ancestral, and unceded territories of the Coast Salish, Stolo, Squamish, Musqueam First Nations, as well as the Whadjuk Noongar people of Australia. And while this story takes place in Paris in 1943, we are honored to live, work, and play on these lands tonight. And we are welcoming back some guests this evening. So June, welcome back. Who are you and what do you do?
I'm June. I'm an actor and creator in Vancouver, BC, and I'm so happy to be back playing.
Amazing. Thank you for being here and welcoming back to the wonderful table this evening. Dag, thank you so much for being here.
Hi. Yep, it's great to be here. My name is Michael. I'm the Dead Aussie Gamer. As you can probably tell from my camera, I'm from Australia, so everything's upside down. And I'm super, super stoked to be here. If you want to find my stuff, I'm everywhere. But right now, I'm super excited to be playing Flint, the goodest of boys in this game. And I'm ready to tear apart some Nazis.
Amazing. Well, thank you for being here. And you will see a new face at the table this evening. And we are down one this evening. Cody has had some computer issues, so we are not able to have them on stream tonight. But stepping in is the fantastic Faye. Faye, who are you and what do you do?
Hi, my name's Faye. You might know me across the internet as Mandari. I like to write a lot of D&D stuff. I do a lot of world building. I write a lot of mechanics. I goof around a bunch. And then sometimes I do streams over here, like At the Edge of All Things, which is best game.
and Triangle Agency.
And Triangle Agency. Actually, a lot of other things. I've also noticed that I've basically, this character included, only ever come onto Blackwater and played Doms. I don't know why that, I don't know how that happened, but you know what? It's certainly a vibe. And I'm happy to be here.
I certainly don't have a problem with it. And you do a great job. So, we're very happy that the three of you are here. And a huge thank you to folks from sweet, sweet Blackwater cast members, Yanis and Sean and Adam. Thank you for being here and playing with me this evening. So before we sink our teeth into this story, we're going to review our content warnings and some tone acknowledgements off the top of the show, just like we did last week. This game was created by the incredibly talented team over at Rowan, Rook, and Decard, namely game designer Grant Howitt, who has done games like Honey Heist and a bunch of stuff with Critical Role as well, which is really cool. Art by Will Kirkby, production and proofing by Mass Hamilton, with sensitivity consultation by James Mendes Hodds and Rue Dickey. We've also hired Rue as our sensitivity consultant here for this miniseries and are so gracious for their time and advice to ensure that we showcase the fun of this game while also giving the scenarios the respect they deserve. So this game was created as an act of creativity to reflect their frustration with the real world's ongoing Nazi problem. This game is a heavily inaccurate fictionalization of the events that occurred in the late stages of World War II, and our content warnings here include death, violence, grievous injury to player characters and non-player characters, blood, vampirism, mental domination, guns, animated corpses, werewolves, occult magic, fascism, Nazis, and Hitler. This is not a horror game for the PCs because they are so ridiculously powerful, but it is a horror game basically from the perspective of anybody who opposes them. And we are actively employing safety tools here as a cast, understanding each other's lines and veils, as well as the lines and veils that are inherently built into the game, which is very, very cool. They talk about all of this stuff. They talk about how to set tone at your table. So it's really, really well done with that. And we're trying to follow those as best we can. The tone of this game is ultra violent. It's imprecise and it's over the top, and it encourages players to rip apart Nazis in almost cartoonish ways, which is really amazing and super fun. We also want to acknowledge the actual atrocities that were committed in World War II by the Nazi regime and extensions of fascism. And we want to honor the hundreds of thousands of lives lost and acknowledge the persecution of Jewish, Romani, disabled, queer, and other minority groups through the Holocaust as acts of terror and genocide. And while our story centers around these incredibly powerful vampires who are here to save the day, we want to put out there that it was real life human beings who kicked Nazi ass and would have continued to kick Nazi ass even if he had employed witches and werewolves. And many narratives from World War II generate pathos by focusing on the helplessness, passivity, and victimhood of the groups that the Nazis targeted. But it is important to highlight that every one of these groups mounted really determined resistance against the Nazi war machine, sometimes against impossible odds, sometimes in full knowledge that they wouldn't survive, and sometimes knowing that they would go home to countries that defeated the Nazis and still face hatred and persecution there as well. So these are all the things that we're keeping in mind as we enter in this evening. And we also are going to be really, really ready to have a good bit of bloodthirsty fun. So sit back, get ready for a little of the old ultra violence. Faye, roll the clip, roll the clip, roll the clip, roll the clip. We are back. Okay. So in our last session, in late 1943, our six Fang commandos, Iryna, Astrid, Nicole, Chuck, Cosgrave, and Flint, were called to Fang Command for one last job, hearing about the defecting of British intelligence agent Henry Oswald to the Third Reich. They were tasked with dropping into Paris to hunt down and destroy the Ubermensch, a secret project involving super soldiers, witches, and potentially werewolves that Hitler had plans to unveil in 3 days' time. They stocked up, they got hungry, and they went into coffin fall over the lights of Paris. They crash-landed in the Place de la Sirene, they disrupted a German military funeral, navigated the catacombs under the city, liberated the Saint-Médard Church, and we pick up as they are hustled into Checkpoint Charlie. So, as Lieutenant Richard Stewart of the Seaforth Highlanders hustles you inside Checkpoint Charlie, he slams the door closed behind you and flips this giant lever on the wall as you step inside into the main front chamber. You see six huge wrought iron bars go kind of go, and they like, bar the door super, super firmly, clicking into place. Seeing Lieutenant Stewart, he's wearing a dark green tam o'shanter, a deep green army officer's jacket with a Fang insignia on his lapel, a small Canadian flag on his collar, and a House Mackenzie tartan kilt with a white sporran. We are glad to see you. Commander Slate sent word that you'd be headed through Sector 3, and we're just really happy you made it. Let's get you up, and then let's get you set out into Sector 2. We've got about an hour while we clear the last of the civilians from Sector 2, and make sure you go see Abjurist Adelaide when you're ready to go. She's finishing the disruption of the obfuscation wards on the sector, and she'll give you your map that you'll need to set on your way. Apparently, Bravo's locked in pretty tight in the surrounding area. We'll need some major clearing before you head into Sector 1. So he takes you down a small hallway, and there are walls with pictures of other troops and operatives who have been part of the war. And you see there are some photos here where there are both humans and some that are very obviously vampires hanging out together on the wall. And this looks to be just prior to the forming of Fang. I'm going to have everyone roll a search for me, please. So take whatever your search stat is, and you can roll that there just flat.
Just the one success.
Okay.
One success.
Okay. One success for you, Adam.
Yep, yep.
Okay.
Just the one success for me.
Okay.
Successes are three or higher? Or
three
higher?
Or higher.
Okay. And
four
I rolled.
Oh, sorry. Four or higher.
Four or higher. And then sixes are double successes, correct?
Yes.
Correct.
Okay. I rolled one six, so I have two successes.
Great.
So two crits, apparently.
Yeah. Amazing. Nice. So four successes for you. Okay. So great. The check wasn't very high here. So who are we going to start with first? Nicole, as you're walking down the hallway, kind of briefly scanning the pictures as you kind of maneuver your rifles and see what needs to be fixed as you go through Charlie, one picture catches your eye on the wall. You see a picture of a very familiar, dark-haired woman in a candid shot, leading what looks to be target practice on a training field somewhere, wearing an officer's jacket. She looks just as you remember her. Fierce eyes, a wicked smile, and a wildness to her that you would never want to tame. It seems like there was a bunch Siobhan didn't tell you.
Oh, Siobhan. She kind of strokes the picture, and they're still like a little dazed from combat, so they kind of are stumbling a little bit, but they want to go find the armory. Mm-hmm. They want to find some guns. And so they round the corner and they see this like red-haired woman who's in a green jumpsuit with the Fang emblem. And she has a ring of keys around her. And Nicole just clocks this and like goes right up to her and says, "Have you got anything heavy?"
You see this woman standing at what looks to be the edge of an elevator that's going to take you down, and she seems to be the elevator operator. So she's holding the keys that open the elevator lock, and she says, I usually carry, but I'm stationed inside Charlie, so we don't usually have to have anything on me, but that can be fixed very quickly.
I think it should.
Yeah, absolutely. Are you going downstairs?
That's right.
Yeah.
That's right, love.
Great. Okay, great. Yeah, I can absolutely make that happen for you. And she is beet red. She is blushing so hard as you walk down the tunnel towards her. So while that's happening, behind you, Chuck, you see a framed document on the wall, and it seems to be, from what you can read from it, an accord between the British military and the US military about Fang actually being a joint forces project. And you see that Lieutenant Broadman was actually supposed to be the commanding officer and the liaison for any of the US vampire commandos. You didn't know that. And you're... When When Lieutenant Broadman first found you, you tried to hide that you were a vampire from him, but it seems like he knew all along. And you see attached to this is an edict to search the country, the entire states, for signs of vampire activity, assuming they would find individuals potentially already incarcerated on murder charges or being held accountable for deaths that couldn't be explained.
I think he would sort of tuck that information in the back of his head and file it away for when he gets the opportunity to speak with him again. Actually, I think you might try and take it.
Okay. You can roll sneak for me.
Yeah. I don't even know if he's going to sneak. I think he might just like...
Take it?
Take it. Take okay. it, smash the glass and pull the paper out. Fold yeah. it up and put it in his pocket.
At the smashing of the glass, you see Lieutenant Stewart turn around and go, "Everything okay?"
Yeah. Looks like I forgot something here.
Sure. Okay. Yeah, sounds great. Awesome.
Yeah.
Glad you found it, Chuck.
All right, let's mosey on.
Okay. We'll move next to Iryna. So, as you're walking down the hall, from everything you knew, your family was relatively uninterested in the war and being any part of it. It was rarely talked about in your house. It was something that everyone outside the walls of your estate did. And frankly, it was your involvement and being a part of Fang and your enjoyment of the process that seemed to fracture your household and send some of your relatives off to more what they called suitable climates. However, as you walk down the hallway, you see a picture of a much younger looking Commander Slate shaking hands with your older sister, Natalia. You see, it's a faded photo. Seems to be ripped a little bit at the edges. There's a blood stain or two in the corner. It looks about 15 years old.
Natalia, you devious cow. Well, I always knew you had some secret or two. Gosh, my family is attractive. Great.
Yeah, she's beautiful. She's stunning.
Carry on.
Amazing.
We're so beautiful. So good looking.
Okay. Flint, with those four successes you've got there, you're kind of lumbering and limping down the hallway, and you stop for a moment to try and adjust yourself so that this hallway is quite crammed. Your wings are boxed in kind of already as it is. And you stop and your eyes settle on a photo. It's small. You probably would have missed it otherwise. And you see a picture of a cave. Your cave. You see it's a landscape-esque photo with a small church in the foreground. Your cave looks to probably be about 300 to 500 feet away from where the photo is being taken. You see there is a briefing attached to it, and it states, "Unknown being living in harmony with surroundings in the Polish countryside. Sister Mary Stella of the Blessed Sacrament of the Holy Martyrs of Nagrodznik has accepted caretaking duties to ensure the being is not disturbed and left to thrive on in its own natural habitat." As you stand there, you have this split second memory when you were just a pup and you looked out the cave, peeking on the horizon as the sun went down before your nightly feed. And you remember seeing someone dressed all in black, standing on a hill not far from the cave entrance.
Flint immediately stops. I imagine while we're walking, you know, there are some Fang soldiers who are kind of like with us, kind of escorting, especially because mm-hmm. Flint has a tendency to drift. As he sort of stops I imagine a couple of the Fang soldiers sort of unintentionally bump into him as he just starts staring at this photo. The large wingspan and the huge bulking body of Flint, just not moving from the procession. He begins to whimper in a very soft tone as he just looks at this photo and seems to sort of just be staring at it. A couple of the Fang soldiers kind of, it to them, it just like with his like kind of eyes as big and kind of wide as they are, it's hard for them to pick which photo is exactly drawn his attention. But in that moment, Flint sort of like just starts pouring at the wall before one of the Fang soldiers sort of pulls him aside and sort of tries to sort of urge him forward.
Yeah.
Eventually, he kind of looks at that soldier, and there's this fleeting moment of just anger, like this snarl across his face, his teeth cracked and broken from the battle against the snipers, holes in his wings and stuff like that. He looks fierce, but it's only a fleeting moment, as his mind then goes back to the church, where out the front, where there are kids playing and stuff like that, there's this tiny baby Flint that is rolling around in the dirt, chasing chickens and the like. Flint actually catching one of the chickens, and just before he's about to sink his teeth and rip it apart, there's the stern voice of the sister cutting over, who then explains to Flint what violence is and explains to him why it's important to not take the lives of the innocent and to be a good boy. Flint then very gently puts down the chicken, who is mostly just a chicken and looks confused at the situation. But then back in the hallway, glaring at this soldier who's pushed him, Flint's expression then shifts. He becomes calmer and he leans over and just sort of makes this nuzzling, purring, kind of snarling sound as he then turns and continues to walk down the corridor with everyone else.
As this kind of nameless soldier stands there with you, kind of looks at you and he goes, "You should go down to the chapel, buddy. There's one downstairs. You should go down." And he helps you over to the elevator. Astrid, you catch the eye of something very briefly. It's not a photo, but it seems to be a report framed on the wall. You see it written about a rogue entity that was suspected to be roaming the ranges of the Trollheimen Mountains, where your plane went down. There are a few solid accounts, but all anecdotes report that it's something very, very old. Stuff that they've written folk tales about. Stuff from more of like the medieval time period. You see a couple of sketches, and as you're scanning through, your mind pulls back to the crash. You don't remember much other than waking up in searing pain in your neck as you threw whatever it was off of you with strength that you didn't know you had. You have this vague image of it lumbering off into the sparse woods in the tundra, covered in a deep, void black fur, satisfied with its feed and bestowing a fraction of its power to you.
Does the paperwork, or like I guess like the old folktales, does it have any descriptions of what the creature is or anything about like where it came from?
It looks mostly like every time it's said to come out of the woods, so people stopped building their homes near the woods and stopped, you know, building their homes near this specific set of woods in the tundra, which is right near where your plane crashed. And all of the accounts seem that it's this just great black furred behemoth with, you see bright red eyes and long fangs that extend far past its jaw.
I think that Astrid probably has a bit of a moment of kind of remembering, like, going down and seeing it run away, and whether this is actually something that she remembers or sort of something that's now there because of reading this, like just seeing the eyes flash as it runs off into the woods. And I think she probably just kind of growls a little bit and walks towards the elevator.
Amazing. And finally, Cosgrave. You don't see anything about you specifically, but you do catch one photo. You see the image of a nun. And by the looks of the photo, it's probably about 100 to 150 years old. You see a stoic woman wearing a familiar styled habit. The label on the photo says, Mother Millicent Eugenia, First Mother Superior of the Sisters of Our Lady of Perpetual Ruin. There is a handwritten quote that is scrawled beneath it that says, The holiest soul in all of England.
Cosgrave will perhaps unconsciously reach into the many folds of his many layers and just make sure that that unassuming jar on his person is still safe and in the pocket that it belongs into, and he feels a bit of a chill go up his spine. He definitely notices, like, everyone else having a moment where, like, everyone else is kind of represented on the wall, and he's gonna and he'll gesture to the nameless soldier.
You mean Lieutenant Stewart? Like the
no, the nameless soldier who is helping Flynn.
Yeah, one of them. Another one of them.
Private Less may have a word.
Yeah, of course. What can I help you with?
Who goes on the wall?
Well, I'm not the one that curates it. It is generally...
That's not what I asked. Who goes on the wall?
It's information and reports that are found that are associated with Fang Command.
Okay. Yeah. Yeah, that makes absolute sense. So if someone needed to... If someone wanted to be on the wall...
Yes.
They would have to be associated with Fang Command.
Likely, yes. They would have to be a part of the operation, a part of the work that you folks do here.
Poor people, poor people. You want to be a vampire?
What?
You want to live forever?
The soldier actively takes a couple steps back from you. How quiet are you saying this?
I am right up in his personal space.
You're going to have to roll sneak to make sure Lieutenant Stewart doesn't hear you.
Absolutely.
You are in a confined hallway near an elevator.
That's a crit success and two regular ones for a four.
Okay, so you have four successes as you. I'm going to roll an opposed sneak for Lieutenant Stewart. I'm not sure how opposed
rolls
go. It's okay.
It's,
okay.
It's just us. It's just us.
Yeah, he only rolled one success. So you look at this soldier and his eyes go wide. I don't want to seem disrespectful, but we've been actively instructed to not do that.
Hey, that's the cool thing about being a vampire, my guy. You don't listen to anybody. You want to live forever?
I want to keep my job here in the army. I got a family back at home, man.
That is the saddest answer I've ever heard. And I'll just walk into the elevator.
This officer that you have just absolutely cornered and confronted with the prospect of an unwanted or unassuming like immortality, he just is kind of stock still and he just stands staring at the wall.
As the doors close, I shout, Hell is a real place, by the way. Good luck.
As the doors close, seeing, because that was one of the guys who was handling Flint.
Yes.
Cosgrave, you kind of like see, like leaned up, kind of curled around the wall next to you is Flint, who's watched you harangue this poor guy who is helping him. And you just see this sort of toothless snarl as my teeth are still broken. Just,
I know, no accounting for taste.
Lieutenant Stewart ushers you all into this elevator and you closes the door and you head down much farther than you anticipate. And he goes,
Well, we've utilized access to the sewers and the catacombs to build our own system down here. So far, we've been able to protect it from scrying or Nazi infiltration, but we've been stationed here in Paris undercover for about a year now. We're here to facilitate Fang operations and also ferry anybody out of Paris who needs it. I will be your liaison while here. You consider me an extension of Commander Slate. So you finally arrive with a clunk at the bottom as the shaft doors open, and you see a veritable hive of activity down here, very similar to the feeling of Fang Command in London. You walk past a sign on the wall that says, please obtain written permission for all rituals prior to initiation. And below that, someone has taped a sign that says, it's been 2 days since our last ritual error. Keep it up. Lieutenant Stewart turns to face you and he says, please feel free to make use of whatever resources you'd like down here at Charlie. You should find anything and all that you need. If there's anything I can do for you, don't hesitate to ask. We do have one request, similar to what Commander Slate discussed. We ask that you don't feed here, if possible. We've had a couple incidents of blood frenzy with previous operatives, and while I trust that all of you would conduct yourselves very well and professionally, we like to minimize our risk to our human personnel. And as Slate says, Command likes you hungry. So that's policy down here. Is that all right with all of you?
Peachy.
Good. All right. Well, I'm going to take my leave, and you can find me if you, and please make sure you see Abjurist Adelaide on your way out. So he walks off, and mechanically down here at Checkpoint Charlie, all of your weapons are revitalized and cleared of any previous uses. I will also say for this short rest that you will allows you to clear up to 2 of your injuries. But other than that, you are going to have to find somewhere sneaky to feed. And it is 3 blood per injury clearing if you have other injuries that need clearing. So there's a bunch that you can do down here at Checkpoint Charlie. We'll try and keep it brief because they want you back outside within the hour after the Abjurist is finished clearing the ward. There's 5 regions down here in Charlie that you can go to. You can go to the chapel, you can go to occultism, you can go to firearms and machinery, you can go to tech, or you can go to intel. And then you'll see the Abjurist on your way out. Also, if you receive any loot in here or while you're out on a mission, these can be added to your inventories for use without occupying a weapon slot. So you get these on top of everything else, and they do not count towards your, like, it's not like you can only attune to 4 things. You can just have a giant fucking list of things. That is totally okay with me. So, where would you like to go?
Chuck would make his way down to weapons and machinery.
Okay. Anyone else heading to weapons and machinery?
Flint.
Nicole is as well.
Okay. So we'll start there. So we head down to firearms are you looking more for tech or are you looking more for weaponry?
Weaponry.
Okay. Weaponry. Okay. So we'll head over to firearms and artillery. And you see 3, you see what very much looks like French resistance fighters. So they are wearing the colors of France. They are kind of like piecemeal, no official uniform. These aren't part of the French military, which has obviously been disbanded under German rule. But these are French, like hardcore French resistance fighters. There are like, one is rolling cigarettes in the corner, and one of them is kind of examining what looks to be a very a broken German rifle and looking to see if he can repair it. And they kind of all look up at you. Can we help you?
Yeah, I'm looking for something like this. I put my guns down on the counter, but maybe packs a bit more of a punch.
Well, I mean, it's slim pickings here, my friend. We are just going amongst what we get brought in. Did you want us to take a look to see if we can like boost what you've got, or would you prefer something bigger?
Well, these are already pretty good when I'm up close. What
did
else
you want
you do?
Something to make it better for far away?
Yeah, maybe. Do you have anything that can make it pack more of a punch? Slightly larger caliber?
Yeah, and you
blow them away.
He takes over your rifle, and you see the last name, Latrec, on a small insignia on his jacket. And he looks at your gun, opening it, flipping around the barrel. And you see him think for a second, and he pulls out underneath bullets. And they look as if they could fit in your gun, but there is some writing on the side. It looks to be in German, potentially, and you see a box of four shells. You see a box of four pieces of ammunition. And he goes, if you want to pack a punch, this will pack a punch, and they should fit in your gun just fine. Just be careful that they don't blow up your gun. I do not think I could fix them, but I have seen this go straight through metal, no problem.
All right. Thank you, Kenny.
And so you, those are, if you say that you are using an explosive round, you have four explosive rounds now.
Perfect. Is there like a...
You can add a +2 dice.
Perfect.
Yeah.
Do you have something like that for me? Nicole like pipes up and you can see they're like very agitated and like very clearly kind of angry and mad. And they're, yeah, approach these men.
So one of the ones that was rolling cigarettes in the corner as the one with the last name Lautrec is helping Chuck. One, he licks a cigarette, kind of puts it in his mouth, and he lights it, and he comes over to you, and he pulls another one out of his pocket and extends it to you.
Anything else? Any grenades? Anything that can bloody blow up the fucking Nazis?
Well, I mean, we can do that for you for sure. I mean, we have been blowing up Nazis since they came into the city, you know. After they shot Bon Sargent, that was it for me. Trop c'est trop, you know? So he takes a look at your machine gun. Actually, and extends his hands to take a look at it. So he kind of like turns it around a bit, and he pulls out what looks to be kind of a scope. It's about this long, and it looks to extend and be telescopic if you needed it to be. And he's like lit the cigarette, and you just hear him muttering about, like, you hear the phrase "fuck les corbeaux." You hear the phrase that they like fucking put a swastika on the Palais Bourbon. Like, you hear him just muttering away about how much he fucking hates the Nazis here in Paris. And you hear another one of the Les Résistants pipe up about defacing French pride and that they should conduct themselves with respect in their city. And so he has installed a scope on your machine gun, and you get a plus for long distance. You also get a plus for holding your breath.
Hmm.
So if both of those are in there, you get a +2. And then one of the one who was talking about defacing French pride looks over at you, Flint. Can I help you, friend?
So Flint, in the moments that these guys have been not paying attention, has made his way over to a table and is just knocking things over as he's just smelling around. Yeah. Flint is very hungry and he's not allowed to eat, and that's made him very sad. So they notice that Flint turns around to face them as they address him, and Flint's got like a claymore in his mouth.
One of them comes up to you and he says, my friend, my name is Maurice. May I take that for you? I have something that might be better than this, which will blow your mouth to smithereens. And you need those. You need those for food, yes?
There's a very throw, don't take kind of vibe.
Right. So Maurice walks over to a table, and you see him pull out these long canisters. They seem to have a pin that you could hook a claw in and pull out. And they seem to be glowing a bit of a blue in them. And he hands them over to you, and he says, or he extends it to you, he says, now, what you do... What we've been told that you do is you really like to get in and you rip them apart before you have a nice lunch, right? Yes? So you throw one of these in the room. If they are wearing any metal helmet, it'll ding them around. It'll give them a concussion before you can get in there. It'll stun them. Yes? Good?
You watch as Flint sort of leans forward. And he does that thing where the dog tries to like get everything in his mouth, but it clearly can't fit. So you watch as he's like, he's very gentle. And he kind of like opens his mouth a little too much. The claymore falls into Maurice's hand as he grabs the other one. And he thinks that he's got both of them in his mouth. And you just watch as he kind of puffs out his chest and on all fours kind of trots out like
the
yes, I have done it. I have got all the things.
Amazing. So Maurice very adeptly catches the claymore and places it gently back down on the table. And you have two echo grenades, which are essentially concussion grenades. And if any of the soldiers around are wearing metal helmets, that's a plus one. Plus one for metal helmet. Okay, so that would be firearms and artillery. Is there anywhere else anybody would like to go?
I would love to go to tech.
Okay, so you head in to tech, Iryna, and you see a small woman wearing an RAF officer's jacket. She has a small navy blue hat on. She looks like she might be originally from India. And she has these beautiful brown eyes, and she looks over and she goes, "Oh, hello. How can I help you?"
"Hello, darling. I was looking at the list of things that we might be able to procure, and one item in particular caught my attention. So right at the bottom, tank."
You're looking for a tank?
"I would love a tank."
"Unfortunately, as you see, with the size of the room I have here, I do not have a tank in it." "Do you have any technology that you found that needs fixing? I specialize in working with radios."
"Well, I was excited about the prospect of a tank, but if you don't have a tank for me, darling, I don't know if you have anything for me."
"If you are, you're going through the next sector now, correct?"
"And apparently without a tank."
"I would, if you swing by... There is a German technology pavilion. I'm not sure if it's on your way out, but if there is going to be any of their classified tech, Hitler likes to put it on display as a show of force. It would be there."
"Darling, if there's a tank there, it is directly on our path."
What is your name? It is just so that I know that you've logged that I can log that you've asked me for a tank.
But you can ask. You cannot ask questions here at Checkpoint Charlie. You've got to take notes about every little question you hear. You must be busy with your little fingers."
You see this look come over her face, and she kind of stands up to you. And this person that you have kind of put into a more diminutive role, her presence takes up the room. She steps towards you, and she goes, "I am the spy that has been behind enemy lines for longer than anyone in the RAF. You will treat me with some respect."
"I treat nobody with respect." And I boot them on the nose and I leave. I traipse out of the room.
Okay. Okay.
"Dude, I'm aristocracy. What are you talking about?"
"Sure thing. Okay.
I didn't put her in a diminutive role. Everyone's beneath me."
Okay, so that is what you did to Special Operatives Executive Noor Inirayat Khan. Yeah, sure. God, okay,
what great. Line. "I didn't put you in this role. Everyone's beneath me."
Oh, wow. All right.
We love a character who knows what they're about, you know?
Yeah. You just insulted one of the best spies in World War II.
Well, they were so good. Why is Hitler still alive?
It's only an insult if they take it as an insult. You know, just be like a little more thick skin.
Like you're asking her to smile more, my guy. Like
traipsing away.
Okay, so you
my job is done here.
Okay. Anyone else?
Also, Adam, guess who's not getting his tank?
What? We're gonna get to the spy, the pavilion, and we'll see the spy in the tank driving
it
away.
That's fucking funny. That's good. We'll find the tank somewhere, darling.
Astrid, would you like to go anywhere?
Yes. So two things. One, I would love to go look at the occult area.
Absolutely.
But on the way there, I don't super know how abilities work. So let me know if I'm doing this wrong. But I have an ability called Blood Hunt. which allows me to track targets or search for things using my sense of smell.
Sure.
And a bonus if there's someone fleeing. And I actually want to know if there is any type of like medical area here, or someone who is like tending to anyone who's got like a currently open wound.
Uh-huh.
In the general vicinity.
Okay. Does that prompt you to make a search roll, or is it just an ability you have?
I don't know what that means.
Does it say roll search, or does it say just like you can sense the presence of people in the area?
You know what? It says mark blood, so does that cost a thing?
Means you have to drink blood to do it.
I have to drink blood to do it. Okay, then I'll just, I guess, just be still same vibe, just not with that ability, I guess.
Okay, I'll say that you're going to keep your senses open, and because you're not using blood hunt, it's not like you're going to be able to ping someone in this place, but if you come across someone, you will probably be more adept at figuring out. Okay,
and
so you,
sorry,
go
just
ahead.
To clarify, we retain the blood from...
Yes, you do.
Okay, cool.
Yes.
Cody has informed me that they had no blood. So
no bloods.
No bloods. Very bloodless.
No bloods. Well, you're going to have to go get some. So you head over to kind of this curtained off area. You get this intense hit of like patchouli and sandalwood as you walk into the room. And you see on one side this lavender-haired human who is gently helping up an officer who had been lying on the ground, and they wave them out of the room. And on the other side, as you're kind of keeping your senses open, just down a little bit of a hall, you smell something delicious. It's not chemical, but it's savory, but it's not blood. It's as if there's something cooking, and it's been a while since you've eaten human food, but if you were to, this would smell very appetizing. So you have someone, an occultist in front of you, and then something that smells really, really delicious down the hallway.
I think I'm gonna be like, whoop, and go redirect to that area.
Does something delicious?
I'm assuming as a vampire, I can't have human food.
I mean, you don't know what's down there yet. You don't know if it's actually food. So you saunter down this hallway and you see, as you come in the room, a set of beakers and burners, and you see someone with goggles on, and you see like, their hair has kind of been, kept in a hairnet, and there is kind of like, charcoal on their faces, look as if something's kind of exploded up at them, and a darker skinned man with kind of short curly dark brown hair who's wearing kind of a red officer's uniform with an apron over top. And as you come in, he just kind of turns the vault, the like the heat down on all of the burners, and he pulls off his goggles and he goes, you're one of the commandos. You have clearance to be here. Absolutely. How can I help you?
I smelled something down here and I didn't know what it was, so I came to find out.
But did it smell bad?
No.
Was it bad?
No.
No? Oh, good. I've been really trying to mask the chemical smell, and you see with something that smells like moderately appetizing, you see at the back, you see a giant pot of soup. That is bubbling. It smells like chile, and there you see corn in it, and you see a bunch of just like delicious, would be more like Southwest or Mexican spices. You just smell this like beautiful, rich, like the smell of like chipotle and adobo and like all of that kind of good stuff kind of bubbling away on the stove.
Ooh.
My name is Marcus. I'm an alchemist here for Fang.
What are you working on, Marcus?
Well, and he kind of pulls a small capsule that he's working on. It's about this big. It looks very, very bright red. If you put it in your mouth and you swallow it, you can... your spit will hurt somebody from a distance. So they've kind of given us free reign to try new things down here, and I wanted to see if I could do something with hot peppers.
Astrid's just gonna kind of grab it, and whether did you say his name was Marcus? Is that what you said?
Marcus. Yeah.
Yeah. Whether Marcus is like cool with that or not, I don't think Astrid really cares. She's just kind of like, and she's just gonna be like, I can take this.
Yeah, absolutely. Go for it. It is a prototype. Everything here is kind of a prototype. So you just let me know, send in your report, like how it is. I'd appreciate that.
Do you have more?
I mean, really the only thing I've been working on right now is this kind of prototype fuel source that I have here. I'm really not sure if it's going to work. This is like my seventh iteration, and it might get you out of a jam really, really quickly, or it could blow you up first. Real six of one, half a dozen of the other, but you're willing to take it and give it a try. It's honestly probably better that you guys try it than any of us. You're a bit more hardy than we are.
Fuel for what exactly?
Yes. Cars, any type of anything that requires a liquid fuel. This could stand in.
Steak man strikes.
Mistake man cometh.
Steak man coming.
Does
ooh, sirloin.
Sorry.
Sirloin the steak man?
Sirloin the steak man.
I can't handle that. That's very good. Fuel, that's what we're talking about.
Yes, we are.
She's gonna go, would this work for alternative types of engines?
Like bodies? No, like, I mean, you probably shouldn't drink it.
I'm gonna take it.
Yeah, so you see there are two uses of this prototype fuel source, and it has a plus to taste it first.
Taste it before, like, taking it fully?
Yeah, you get a plus one dice to taste it first. Yeah.
Okay.
Did you want to head back to the other occultism person before you head out, or are you going to head out from there?
I think that she would, just to figure out what they were doing. Like what the whole laying down situation was.
Okay. So you walk over and the lovely lavender haired human looks up and she goes, hi, my name's Artemnesia. I'm, did you want to try to project?
I'm not sure I know what that means.
Have you heard of astral projection?
No,
you absolutely have not heard of astral projection at all.
I think that Astrid won't actually say anything. She's just going to stare at her.
Well, generally what we do here, when I help facilitate someone reaching beyond their living body and extending their consciousness out to wherever the universe calls them to, generally it is it's a practice amongst us occult practitioners, and I've been brought here to, you know, help as a scout, as it were. So if there was something you were looking for in the next sector, perhaps I could be helpful in opening your mind to that possibility.
Okay. And then Astrid just kind of walks in and lays down, like the way that they saw this guy doing.
Yes, this would be helpful. Is any one of your compatriots around? Generally, we ask for a known spotter. And while I am happy to sit with you and facilitate this experience, generally a guide would be helpful for you. Someone to tether you, that you know.
Did anyone else come down here with me?
Would any of you wandered by?
I'll say that at the door, you kind of expect to see someone helpful, but instead you see Flint, who is just sitting, just upright, with what looked to have been two grenades in his mouth, which you then watch he swallows as he goosenecks them.
Yeah.
And then opens his mouth, his tongue dangles out.
This is one of your companions? She would say to Astrid.
Yeah, she's just gonna kind of nod and just be like, I guess this is happening.
Projectionist Artemnesia Dorian hustles you in, Flint, and kind of sits you in a designated spot
next to her, and she takes Astrid's hand and your hand as well, Flint, and she begins, the lights are, when she starts this soft chanting, the lights begin to dim in the room, and you feel this kind of crackling of energy. The smell of ozone is very thick, as if you have been right around when lightning has struck. What you are doing is Artemisia is going to facilitate an astral projection for you. You get +1 for having an undead spotter. So congratulations with that.
Ooh.
So you're going to roll a search and you are looking for 3 successes.
Okay.
So you get an extra dice, but you can need 3 successes here.
Okay. Oh, I've lost one of my dice to the abyss. That's fine. Okay. I got 3 4s, so.
Fantastic. Okay. So you are lying there, and it as if you her voice begins to fade away, and you feel it is almost as if your conscious mind and yourself disassociate from your body, and you're pulled up and out, and you're kind of like travel through the dirt of the ground, and you see yourself up in the air above where Fang Command is. And it's disorienting for a moment because you're like, you know that your body is exactly where it is, but you're very cognizant that you're not there. You are absolutely not in your body at this moment. And you feel, you kind of turn around and you feel this sense of direction, and you feel your mind pulled in a direction away from where you know the Eiffel Tower is, and you see a concrete structure. There's an audible hum as you as your gaze kind of moves inside, and you see a glow from a far corner of a center display. You see a machine, 4-legged in nature, flanking to be what looks like a set of high-tech armor. You see a small man come into the frame. Spectacles, slicked down hair, in a simple black suit, wearing an SS armband. He smooths down his hair and straightens himself, and he says, "For the Reich." And he goes towards the center console, and you see him flip an illuminated switch on a panel nearby, and you hear a as you watch as power begins to be fed into this high-tech suit. And with that, you just feel the whew, 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 as you kind of like stumble and trip back into your body, and you pop open, and Artemisia has her hand under your head. It's okay. What did you see?
I think that Astrid has a moment of like when traveling through the air, it was disorienting for just a second, and then was also kind of like, oh, this is nice. This is familiar.
Felt like your plane.
Yeah, I can do this. And then doing it backwards, awful.
Really bad.
So she probably just kind of looks up at Artemisia. Is that what their name was? Okay. And says, I saw something not far from here, but something wasn't good.
Okay.
Have we been told about the Ubermensch already?
You have, yes.
Would I make that connection?
You would assume that this is, it looked to be something very important. It's looked like something highlighted in the center, but the only Ubermensch, you don't have any information about what you're looking for. The only Ubermensch that you have potentially heard of is a potential werewolf. This is so far from that.
I think that I maybe saw another place at a testing ground of some sorts, them making something new.
Ground? Like in a... outside of Paris, or...?
Opposite the Eiffel Tower, something. I don't. I'm not quite sure. I think that she would give her the general like idea of like physically where she was.
Artemisia kind of thinks for a moment.
You said it was tech, right? Like a suit? A power suit?
Yes, it glowed and there was a some kind of a panel.
It's the German Technology Pavilion. It's, Hitler has been showcasing tech there, and we haven't been able to get any sort of access inside, but we know there's something that they're working on. Perhaps it's more important than we thought. You'll have to let the Abjurist know, and perhaps she can divert your path and make sure that things are there for you. If I would say to go check it out.
All right. I kind of look at Flint, and I just kind of nod. Thank you.
You're welcome. You're welcome to come back and project anytime.
All right.
And she lets you go.
Flint's still holding her hand.
Cute.
Just kind of be like, all right, bud, let's go. Let's go find the others.
Okay. Yeah. So you visited occult, you visited firearms and artillery, Iryna went into tech, there is intel if you wish to go there, and then Abjurist Adelaide. If there's any,
Cosgrave would like to go to the chapel that you mentioned.
Yeah, okay.
Did I imagine that?
No, you didn't.
That does exist?
You didn't imagine it. It does exist, yes. So yeah. You walk inside, and it looks to be set up like a very similar chapel to Sisters of Perpetual Ruin. These are the all of the sisters here who are work with Fang, and you see four inside who are kind of just cleaning up, and one sits in prayer in the corner. You see a confessional booth. At the corner, there is a Christ on the cross in the corner, and then it just says like the Our Lady of Perpetual Ruin up front, and they kind of all look to you and they go, oh, hello, can we help you?
Yeah, it's been a minute, and I'll head into the confession booth.
Okay, would you like accompaniment or would you like to go by yourself?
Isn't that sort of the bag?
I mean, generally, yes. We never tell people how to engage with their worship, but we would be happy to facilitate a confession if you'd like.
Yeah, please, please.
Okay. So you see one of the sisters, probably one of the older ones, and she introduces herself as Sister Agnes Albany, and she sits in on one side of the confessional booth and opens the door for you to go in the other side.
He hops in and gets... we don't have a lot of time, so I'm just desperately curious. You would describe yourself as a person of faith, yes, Sister Agnes?
Well, I have been a nun for 54 years, so yes, I would say if my faith is quite strong, yes.
Brilliant, brilliant, brilliant. I so rarely have the occasion to speak to people of faith who have first-hand experience of evil, such as myself.
You think yourself evil?
Yes. I eat people, and the sun kills me.
Yet.
I met a ghoul today, and that morally ambiguous wizard they had back at High Command, I know a thing or two about him. Like, he's doing some good here, but that's only to even out the deeply ambiguous things he does. Also, I'm pretty sure you got some werewolves on the picture, like...
Yes. We are more of a separated sect of the Catholic Church. The main order seems to overlook us on purpose most of the time. If you consider yourself evil, I would say you fall somewhere in a... That evil is not a black and white. You fall somewhere in the gray, my friend, and we are grateful for the work that you do here. So.
Do you believe... In a black and white, is there a good and a bad?
This would be the question of whether there is a heaven or a hell, good or bad, up or down.
I'm asking you. You meet people who never die, potentially. I don't plan to. We'll see how this mission goes. And you've devoted yourself to this life. What do you think will happen when you die?
Are you worried about hell, sir?
Only all the time.
I'm drawn to two verses, often, when asked this question. Romans 5:10. For if, while we were God's enemies, we were reconciled to him through the death of his son, how much more, having been reconciled, shall we be saved through his life? And John 15:13. Greater love has no one than this, that someone lay down his life for his friends. I don't think there is a hell. Christ died on the cross so that we may be atoned. So by that, there is no hell. And with what you're doing, what you do for us here in Paris, and beyond that, even if there was a hell, I don't think that would be the first place the universe would send you.
I appreciate your faith. You know, it wasn't the blood loss that got him. It was the daylight. And Cosgrave is going to walk out.
You see her smile and she starts chuckling to herself. And she goes, a gift for you, for the wonderful conversation. And she takes off her rosary and she passes it to you.
You know, it's funny. I know the exact market value of a genuine rosary from someone who believes. It's the belief that makes it worthwhile. Otherwise, it's just a bunch of wood.
That one is more than just a bunch of wood. And you see a metal line down the outside of one edge.
Well, I don't think I'm going to sell it anyways. I appreciate it. Thank you very much.
You're very welcome, Cosgrave.
Good luck getting wherever you're going.
I'll do my best. So you have what is called the Blade of the Martyr.
Oh, okay.
It has two uses, and you have plus for giving them hell and a plus for otherwise unarmed.
Okay.
And it's essentially a concealed switchblade in a rosary.
I see. That's all I want to do. Just curious.
Incredible. Okay. Would anyone like to go to Intel before they leave?
Intel's for nerds.
Yeah, I'll go buy Intel. I'll take the bait.
You see, you go into the room and you see one man sitting in there. He's tall. He's very handsome. He's dressed in a simple dress shirt and pants, suspenders hung down. He has kind of a pencil thin mustache. And you recognize something in him, Chuck. It is something in his eyes tells you that he too knows how to get into trouble. There's a cigarette hanging out of his mouth as he kind of pores over documents, a cloud kind of sitting in the air. And he looks up and he goes, hello?
I figured probably stop in, make sure I know what's going on, what's coming our way.
Yo, Chuck, in it?
Yeah.
You want one?
What's your name?
I'm You can call me Zigzag. Agent Zigzag.
That's a good name.
Thank you. He mimics your accent almost perfectly.
I like you.
What you looking for? What can I do for you?
Anything I need to know? Any idea what we're facing out there?
Well, you're probably looking for information on the Ubermensch. Yeah?
Yeah.
So he kind of turns some documents around and they've got two major projects in the city that we know of. One of them likely in Hitler's airship itself. That's a special one. The early prototype of his little wolfy friends. Very strong, primal teeth, claws. That's what you want to be looking at, trying to rip you apart. The other that we can tell is in the Jardin de Faye. And you hear in his accent, it's not as if a British person is attempting an accent. It's very much that, like, this is very much part of his linguistic talent. Like, he very easily slips into French. We're pretty sure what's going on there is disrupting our flyovers. We've had three planes crash as they're going over the Jardin. And the pilot's barely ejected out of there in time. So just be aware, it'll likely fuck with your machinery and your gear. We're not sure what it is, though.
All right. So, all right. Makes sense. Ubermensch, and then
You're hunting that Oswald, right?
Yeah, figure we take him out while we're out there.
Yeah, good. He's a sniveling snot. I hate him. He ran with me for a while in intelligence. He was all right. All ambition. But he loves to run his mouth and show off. If you see him and he ain't dead, you tell him I'm going to pop round to Giselle's house and take her out dancing. See what he does with that.
No, all right. Do you want me to tell him that before I kill him?
Yeah. I want you to see what his eyes do with that. He's all pride, all mouth.
All right. Well, I'll let him know. You can take Giselle dancing. All right. Make sure I look out for them. What did you say was a dinner fay?
Jardin de Fay.
Jardin Fay.
He says it in your accent so that you can attempt to pronounce it. Means garden of activity, or it's a carnival. The Nazi carnival.
Yuck. That sounds so bad.
Actually, that sounds kind of fun.
How dare they sully carnivals in this way?
I'm going to have you roll a con check. I want to see how much you know about this guy. I've been doing a lot of World War II research, y'all, and I'm trying to put as many actual real people in World War II in this thing as possible, which is very fun.
Do they have to be real people from World War II? Can't just be like Carl Sagan, like, on
I'm
the
not
scene.
Putting Carl Sagan in the show.
Oh, that's too bad.
That was a 4.
Amazing thing about Starhurst.
Okay. Amazing. So you trained alongside some like American operatives who came through your base and kind of, you know, would feed some stuff to Lieutenant Broadman. And you remember kind of hearing some chatter around the mess hall about an agent Zigzag. So from what you remember, he is from a small island called Jersey in the Channel Islands. And he was in prison when the Nazis occupied Jersey. Jersey is the only island to have been occupied by the Germans during the war. And after the Germans captured Jersey, he said that he would work for them. They sent him to Germany to engage in espionage. And once they finished, they dropped him back in England for a bit of counterintelligence. And the first thing he did was he promptly went to the police and then was interviewed by MI5. And he turned tail 3 times. So kind of a triple agent. And is getting himself ready to go back into Germany to fuck up some more Nazi plans. You've heard he is slick, sly, and does a lot of cocaine.
I have 2 questions for you.
Far away.
First of all, when you go in undercover and you get into trouble, how do you let them know you need to get out?
Like, you mean the Brits or the Germans?
Doesn't matter. Whichever side you're trying to get out of.
You make sure you got a radio on you, my friend. And you make sure it's the only one.
Well, I heard some stories about you, and if I survived this, I'd hang on to a radio if you ever need someone to pull you out.
It's very kind of you, my friend. Consider it mutual.
Also, second thing before I go, you got any of the that good stuff?
You see him smile. He opens his jacket, and you see 2 pouches. He puts them in front of you. And you look at one and you can tell that that is absolutely a lovely little bit of cocaine. And you see that the other one is packing tobacco.
Man. I said I'd never fall in love again. All right.
You see him kind of raise his brows and he goes, in another life, my friend, in another life. And he passes the both of them to you.
Well, it's been a pleasure, Zigzag.
Yourself as well, Chuck.
And then I would, very good. I would leave and go find the rest of the group.
Cool.
So the tobacco itself does nothing, but the cocaine will give you... I'm making this up on the fly.
I feel like cocaine should give you a plus one dice to search rolls as you frantically look through everything you own and everything in the nearby...
I would say you get a plus one to your search rolls, and I will say you have probably two bumps of it. Given you just enough to get to
or brawl. Okay. I feel like it's either good for search or brawl.
I feel like it just adds plus one to whatever check you want.
I'm good at stuff now.
Probably not con, probably not sneak, and not terrify, I would argue.
What if it's you sniff the cocaine and you get one dice that you add to anything you want, but you don't count that dice towards successes because you think you're better at it, but you're not really.
You just get to roll it.
You get to roll the dice. It doesn't do anything.
It's more of just a morale boost.
It just feels good. I got a six, but it's the wrong one. Okay. It's over
everyone,
here.
I'll say everyone
plus
has...
to brawl and plus to search.
Yeah, everyone has all their items, everything that they're ready to get out with. Okay, so you, except you didn't have your tank, because you, I'm sorry about that.
Yeah, the fact that they just don't have a tank in this very secretive small location, crazy.
Okay, so you head over to find Lieutenant Stewart, and after finishing your business here in Checkpoint Charlie, and you are led down to find Abjurist Zirsha Adelaide. So she sits alone in a room, incense alight amongst candles in pools of their own wax, and you hear a soft chanting. Her hair is piled up in an exceedingly large bun on the top of her head with maybe 10 or 12 earrings in each ear. Her hair is wrapped up in a huge marigold head wrap to keep it in place. Her clothes are loose and flowing and circling around her as she holds her hands over a map. Her eyes are closed. And as you enter the room, her chanting does not stop, but you see her kind of hold you pause at the door as she finishes. Her chanting kind of swells. You see the firelight on the candles double in size, and her voice takes on this beautiful musical quality to it. You feel your vision start to blur a bit as Cosgrave. You would recognize what she's doing. She's setting wards and maybe a curse or two in the process. The collective presence of your undeath is in high antithesis to the work that she does here. As she finishes, she presses her hands down into the map and all of the candles go out at once. And you hear her say, okay, now you can come in. She picks up the map, which seems to be kind of hot in her hands, and she rolls it up for you and goes to the lantern on the far side of the room. You're ready to go, I'm assuming. Yes? We're good?
Mm-hmm.
You're muted, Faye.
I thought I clicked it. I actually have something that, we may want to look into. I was with the wonderful woman down in the occult room, and,
Artemisia, yes.
Yes. And we saw something, and she will kind of maybe grab the map and sort of
pull
it back out and, like, point in, like, this general area.
The technology pavilion. Okay.
Oh, that sounds like a very important place for us to go visit because of the thing that you have described. We should definitely go there.
Okay, I can...
For no other reason.
I can potentially see if I can reroute your safe routes. You'll have to take the metro there. We've got it working, mostly.
Public transportation?
Yes. From there, you'll probably have to make a sprint for it, but I think there's a car garage on the other side of the pavilion that you might be able to break into, and then you can take that to the Jardin de Fay, where we're pretty sure the other Ubermensch is wreaking havoc. Put them down, however you need to. Checkpoint Bravo is located in a secret entrance under the center of the bright blue merry-go-round in the Jardin. It's Fang colors. You shouldn't be able to miss it. We're hoping you'll be able to contact them to facilitate your entry. We've lost comms with them for about a week. They're barricaded in. We need to get them out. Okay?
All right.
Also, Cosgrave, you know that if you need someone to identify your Babylon candles, this Wampron can probably do it for you, just mechanically so that you have them.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. Just one quick thing. I took three of these, and no more. You recognize them?
You took these from the St. Medard?
It was a gift.
From who?
St. Medard.
Right.
Well, I believe it's pronounced Saint Bernard.
Close enough. These are
Astrid's just standing there with the cross from Saint Bernard.
You just have a giant over cross the giant. Yeah. These are Babylon candles. If you light them, it'll take you from one place to another. Short range, shouldn't be too far. Try not to light too many of them at once. It could potentially cause a mishap.
Could they be used to avoid taking the train like a peasant?
No.
Sounds great. Thanks good. For the tip. You're looking forward to it. Love your work, by the way. Very rewarding.
I am Britain's best abjurist, so yes, that's makes sense that they have me here. But
yeah, it's a real who's who. Everyone who's here is important to England, and we're all very glad to serve King Country.
All of the schools of magic are represented.
All of us.
We don't have a necromancer here, though. The necromancer is at Bravo.
Which one?
The best one, I believe.
Chuck, I wasn't speaking to you.
You'd be correct. London's most prominent necromancer is
Professor Meeball.
It's not Professor Meeball, no.
Oh, well, we don't have the best.
Sean Devner forcefully pushing one of his characters into this lore.
If you're not going to give the character a name, I will.
Yes, they're Zirja smiles, and she says, you should go talk to them.
Cosgrave, darling, they might be a better necromancer than you, but I'm sure they don't have prettier eyes. Take solace in that.
The worst part is they absolutely do.
Oh no, there's nothing you can do then, darling.
Is she?
Yeah, he's got a very large collection of eyes.
He swaps them out day to day. I don't know that trick. It's
And he is faking. He is using tricks.
She walks over to a cabinet on the side and she opens it up and she pulls out four small devices. She hands them over to you. She says, if you make it to the Eiffel Tower, see if you can place these around the four corners of the base before you start your climb. Uh-huh. You will thank me later. And these are effectively called death drops. So if you place four of these around the corner, you need to roll sneak. You need to make four successes, and you won't plummet to your death if you fall.
Over and out.
But all four of them need to be up. If one of them gets destroyed, it will not work. Okay.
So
great. So seeing that you're all ready to go, she leads you down a series of tunnels. And you begin to start hearing the sound of trains rushing in the underground. She leads you to a blank wall, and you see her place a hand in the center of it. She mutters a few words, and the wall fades out of existence. It's barely wide enough for you to stand shoulder to shoulder here, and you see about what looks to be an empty metro tunnel, and you see here the sound of an approaching train about 2 minutes out. So you're going to have to jump for it. I'm going to slow the train down as much as possible. And we'll get the doors have been jarred open for you. But the jump is entirely on you. I have one time ability to try and slow this train down before I have to go take a nap. So don't fuck it up. Okay? Good. Right. Mm-hmm. So the train rushes closer to you as you she leans out the window, seemingly judging the distance of it. She dips back in, closes her eyes, extends her hands, and the train gets closer, closer, closer to the platform as it almost begins to rush past. She sideswipes with her hands, and you feel this huge pulse of energy release from her. It almost knocks you off this platform. And as you prepare to jump, you can use any skill here to try and jump, but you need at least three successes to make it onto the train. If you get two, you will take an injury. If you get one, you will take an injury and you will permanently damage a piece of your equipment. No successes, everything and above, but you make it on the train, but your piece of equipment is shattered and unusable for this leg of the mission.
Question for you.
Yes.
You said that we get to take one of our advances.
You absolutely do. So you can keep that in play, or you can let me know right now whatever you take. That's all good. Also, needs and blades in the chat. Yes, it absolutely will be up on YouTube.
I will absolutely take a crack at this. I'm going to, having refilled my mason jar of ghosts at the pour your own, it's like a soft serve. I'm going to huff some ghosts, which allow me to pass through walls and hopefully just sort of step onto the train, not needing to like get the timing right.
Incredible, love that.
Add me a plus three to my sneak, and yes, there we have it, team. That's two crits at six. It's six successes.
Cosgrave is on the train. This train is slow down. Who's next?
You said we can use
any skill you like. You just have to justify it for me.
Yeah, I'm just gonna muscle my way on. I'm gonna try and smash through a window and use brawl.
100%.
I'm gonna take one of them little hits, do a little key bump, and then bam.
Amazing. Go for it. Fresh gift from Agent Zigzag.
That's also good. Just a straight up thing that probably has happened in real life. Someone done a bump of a cocaine and jumped onto a train.
Yeah. We like to keep things realistic here.
We're all grounded here. Our vampire Nazi game is vampires eating Nazi game is really grounded in reality.
100%, absolutely.
All right. That is two fives, a one, and a six. So four total.
You are fantastic. Chuck is on the train. Who's next?
Could I...
Go ahead, Adam.
Try and...
I'm going to con your way onto this train.
Yeah. Could I just be so good looking and graceful that I just kind of like dance onto the train and like just like tap a long finger onto the side of the train and be like, thank you, darling, as I just like step on really gracefully.
To be fair, you have insulted this train system so much.
Not within its earshot.
Go ahead.
The train couldn't hear me.
I'll let you.
Unless the train's got spies. Also, unless the train's working for the anti-tank lady.
To be fair, Em, I have been insulted by many people I find attractive and still given in the moment they've given me attention.
True.
Absolutely.
I rolled four dice and got four successes. Hell yeah.
Amazing. You are on the train.
And then I flounce down on the chair so just like upset that I'm on a train.
Absolutely. The rest of you.
Nicole is going to like crouch down and then like very gracefully kind of like leap onto the train, and I have four success, so they make it successfully, and they turn Amazing. Back and they yell, tell that ginger woman I'm coming back for her. And as for Siobhan, you can tell her to fuck off.
You just hear like Zirsha just kind of like a like she's like gritting her teeth but acknowledges you that she will do so. Flint or Astrid, what are you doing?
I think that Astrid is going to sort of start like breathing really heavily, being like, and is going to actually sort of go down on like all fours and get very bestial for a moment like absolutely terrifying. face morphing as she just sort of tries to like jump and like barrel into the train.
Incredible.
And
I like the idea of the big cross getting caught like a backpack as the doors close.
Yes.
That's exactly what happens because I definitely rolled a success.
Oh boy. So you rolled one success. So, okay. So you are taking an injury. No, you're damaging a piece of equipment.
And take an injury, you said at the time.
Help?
Yes. How would you like to help?
So I have one bloods paired up from before.
Ooh. Yeah.
And I happen to take a little something on that last one.
Okay.
You as Astrid jumps and I see she's not going to make it, out of my mouth comes I stick my tongue out and it just keeps going and going and going. And I would like to mark blood and use lashing tongue. Your strong prehensile tongue extends several yards out of your mouth, plus one restrain.
Yeah, absolutely. I would say with that easy, you see Astrid kind of get stuck with this giant cross that she has strapped to her back, and you manage to kind of lash your tongue around her and around the cross, and you're able to pull her into the train. You do give her a good tongue lashing, and you get her inside the train. You can't throw that stuff up in the Zoom chat and think I'm not going to say it.
Hey, absolutely. Man, I'm all for it.
Fantastic. All right. And Flint, how are you getting? And you are, I would say that will negate your injury for sure. But to honor that you did fail a little bit, I'm going to say you can pick one of your items and you're going to mark off one that you can't have one use of that item.
So Chuck definitely saved you and negated some stuff there. Okay. Flint, how are you getting on the train?
So as the train is whizzing past, Flint seems to have been distracted as it sort of moves past the platform and notices that everyone has gotten on board. Quickly, he spreads out and unfurls his wings, which already has started to regenerate, and he begins to power fly to the rear of the train. And I'm going to try and grab on to the back door, rip out the rear emergency exit, and then crawl in from the rear of the train with a brawl.
Go for it.
Nice. Okay, so that is 5 successes.
You are good. You do exactly as you say, and you climb into the train. You see just kind of Zeersa just kind of give you one of these out of the tunnel as you speed along by. You hear coming down the tunnel what sounds like motorcycle engines. But the train, because it is moving and you all successfully made it on, quickly outpaces it. You hurtle down the track towards multiple stops, looking out for the German Technology Pavilion. You come to a halt, probably after about a 15-minute train ride, and you start racing up the stairs towards the pavilion itself. And that is where we are going to take our break. So, oh my gosh, thank you to all of you in chat who are watching this evening. We will be posting this episode on YouTube. It's going to be probably released in about a week and a half after the first episode is released there. We are back, going to be back next week, but we're not done with this episode. We will be back in about 8 minutes for our second half. So grab yourself a tasty blood bag and some good snacks, and we will see you quickly after the break. Okay, bye, folks.
Bye-bye.
See you
now.
Bye.
This is our final move. You are the Allies' last hope. The Nazis won't go down without a fight. You have one mission. Drink all of Hitler's blood.
And we are back. So you start heading up the steps towards the German pavilion itself, seeing that this metro station is actually inside the pavilion. And as you come in, you see multiple different arenas and areas that have been set up to showcase German war tech. Their technology has come leaps and bounds in the last half decade with the arms race towards creating bigger, stronger killing machines, essentially has really, really driven the industry here in using the land, the space here in Paris, as well as from Germany. And this exhibition hall aims to show off that to the public. So you see experimental fuel sources humming and glowing behind glass in the darkness in this after-hours hall, informative boards all written in German, singing the praises of newfangled alloys. To your left, you see a state-of-the-art quadrupedal weapons platform. That is in, like, that looks to be deactivated kind of in the center of the arena. So your main objective here is to storm and destroy this pavilion and get out the other side. You also know that your purpose here is likely to find the Ubermensch and destroy it. You can allocate that within your search as well. So I would say if you want to start kind of searching this place, that'll probably be part of your first objective. So if somebody wants to take the helm on the search, go for it there.
I've got a three.
Flint will take to the air and will start to search around. I don't think we're stealthing, and Flint is not a stealthy boy.
Go for it.
So Flint is going to do what he normally does, and unless someone stops him, he is going to screech super loud and use my sense heartbeat thing to try and get a pulse on the pavilion, find the large bodies of people. Or if there's like anything unusual, like say, like a particularly like large ish person, yeah. I don't know. You know what Great. I mean? Like if I, yeah.
Okay. You can roll me a search with that.
Done. So search, plus my sense heartbeat. All right. Three successes.
Fantastic. So I'm going to put that towards the kind of storming and destroying the pavilion objective, which is you've knocked basically in half from an objective six. As you're kind of flying around, Flint, you see what looks to be like a really, the shininess captures your attention, and you see kind of a glow coming from the inside, and you point at it to I guess whoever would be closest, potentially, it could be Iryna, it could be Nicole, kind of flanking on that side as you go to see this kind of really high-fangled tech weapon ready to go.
Is there a large structure I can like kind of roost on as I'm flying?
Yeah, so I would say there's probably something up top, like a what's that called? Like a palisade or like a bar that you could sit on there as well. Yeah.
Yeah. So sitting on that palisade, Flint is just sort of going to unleash this roar where like just his fangs, his spittle, his eyes, his demeanor, his posture is all pointing in that direction. So that, everyone can
you
see.
And you can hit the heartbeats
what
as well.
What I found.
Yeah. So you also hear at least two heartbeats to start. One is racing. One is so, like, you just feel the panic. You can hear the panic in this person's heartbeat. It is accompanied by, like, what you feel is kind of like the sound. You can hear the sound of heavy breathing. And the other heartbeat is slow. Very, very slow. Like, way too slow for any potentially, like, typical human being heartbeat that you have heard. So with that, I would say either, yeah, Iryna or Nicole would be closest to this, kind of see this weapon that Flint has pointed out. Would either one of you like to go pick it up?
Oh, definitely Nicole goes to pick it up.
Okay, so you see this really high-fangled German tech weapon. You see it's got kind of this blue-green core in the center with coils that are circling around the outside, and you see a kind of a calibration tool on the side, and it says in German, please calibrate before firing. And what you have in your hands is a proton beam emitter, and you get a plus four for properly calibrated before firing, and you get one use of that. So that is a one-time use with a plus four if you calibrate it, and so you can add that onto a shoot roll, but it is a one-time shot.
Wow, cool. Good boy, okay. Fang. I give him a little... I don't know if I'm up by him, actually. He's far up,
you,
but I just...
Yeah, you could kind of wave to him in the rafters.
Yeah.
So you're making your way down to the center of the arena where you see banners strung up promising the future of warfare, and you hear a platform kind of hissing and grinding in front of you like it's powering up, and you begin to hear all the crunch of metal on metal as you see the steel shutters of the top of the pavilion start to close you in. You have now just been locked into the pavilion that you'd attempted to break into. And as you're looking around, the rest of you start to hear that sound of heavy breathing, accompanied by the clunk of something being connected and the loud powering up noise. Suddenly, a series of spotlights turn on and illuminated in the center of the floor, also standing atop a platform. You can assume what you can be the first Ubermensch that you have run into, with a banner behind saying Stahlsoldat, Stahlsoldat. Now, it had been said that Hitler had always hoped to create a legion of half-man, half-machine warriors, where you would take a willing, exemplary soldier and pistons begin to replace muscles, steel replaces skin, and the troublesome parts of the brain are cut away till only the bare instinct of killing remains. In a move that people would somehow describe as unwise, Hitler has seemed fit to have the now previously dormant Stahlsoldat on display in the pavilion instead of placing a replica or a double here. Your attention is then drawn to just behind him, where you see a small, bespectacled man, Astrid, the same one you saw in your vision, with a black suit and an SS armband, his hair slicked down, running for what you assume to be his life out of the pavilion. The pavilion is loaded with atmospheric monitoring equipment, finely tuned thermometers, pressure sensors, light reactive plates. You figure that if Stahlsoldat powers up and reaches full capacity, it will be able to detach itself from this platform, sense the world around it with uncanny accuracy, and be a super soldier capable of killing anything in its path. So, the weapons platform that you see next to it as well could potentially also give you usage to it, and it looks to have a fuel canister in its place. All right, so I'm going to throw a bunch of objectives here as we get into combat. For those of you out there, shit's going to get real violent real quickly, so I'm going to put that as a content warning out here. The rest of your objective is to storm and destroy the rest of this pavilion. That's an objective level 3. You have an optional objective of a level 5 of powering up the weapons platform. You also have an optional objective B of capturing SS agent Henry Oswald, which is an objective 6. You also have Stahlsoldat in front of you, which is a threat level 6, challenge rating 2, oof, with an attack of 4. He has inch-thick armor and also pneumatic claws and a scatter gun. What would you
Are there any Nazis nearby to eat?
You see one very delicious-looking defective British agent in front of you, and you assume that potentially Stahlsoldat, you could feed on him as well.
Okay.
I would say, from the looks of how big Stahlsoldat is, you could probably get like 4 blood out of him.
I have an advance.
Yeah.
But I was like, I'm going to take this because it seems insane.
Do it.
Mark Blood. On your next attack roll, gain the special, reduce an Ubermensch's threat rating to zero, killing them. Like, can I just dome this dude? Like, I don't fully understand the wording of that ability. Can I just be like, head pop, boop?
Yeah, describe.
Am I just golden gunning this guy?
Describe to me how you golden gun this guy.
Oh, sick. Okay, yeah.
If you're going to do this, I'm going to say that this is a once per episode thing.
Yeah, oh, like, fully. That would be it's like killing every Ubermensch.
You can't take all my Ubermensch, okay?
Absolutely not.
It's also an exchange rate of one for four blood.
Yeah. So what would you like to do? How would you like to absolutely obliterate this first Ubermensch?
So I'm going, I guess I have to succeed. I have to make some sort of check and succeed at it in order to then kill.
Yes.
Okay, so I'm going to, is there any high ground that I could get to that is really
absolutely
intense metal?
I would say that you could probably scale up some of the equipment and jump up onto some of the pavilion like showcases here. Absolutely.
I'm going to like kind of gracefully up somewhere high. Take a drag out of my once per episode. Well, I've made it once per episode because it doesn't recharge and I have three of them.
Yes.
So I take a drag out of my hanged man cigarette, point the gun. And I think it's like, I'm going to shoot. And in the TV show of this scene, it looks like I've missed, like it's just fully missed everything. Cause this guy's like a mech thing, right?
He's a mech in a suit, essentially.
Awesome. So I'm going to shoot. And I'll make my roll to see if I do just actually miss.
Yes.
I'm going to use a charge from my exquisite hunting rifle.
Do it.
I'm elevated.
I'm also like emotionally elevated about it because you're one-shotting my Ubermensch. It's fine.
Sorry. Yeah. I'm so sad, but it's just my ability.
That's fine. That means I get to throw another one at you this episode.
Yeah, exactly. Okay. And I have to get, I'm assuming, one success. I have to get three or more successes because I have to beat the challenge rating of two.
Yes.
Cool.
If you can get one success, that means you can do it.
Sweet. There's a four, a four, and a five, and then the other two are useless, but that is three successes.
Yes. So you hear this as the first shot off from the from Iryna perched high up on, and you see it clears through.
Well, so I think...
Go for it.
I fire, and this big mech Nazi like whips by as the bullet misses, and hits a lamp behind, and the lamp falls down, and we like spin around, and we see one of the tubes that is like moving into this person's body has been severed by the bullet and is leaking a fuel, and the lamp shatters. Goes up into the fuel, and then you watch his flame gouts out of his eyes and mouth.
Incredible.
And he just goes,
yeah,
as I
incredible
explode this guy from internally.
Fantastic. Stealth Soldat burns in front of you now. So you still have your objectives here. You still have power up the weapons platform if you'd like to do that. And I had put in a caveat that if you killed Stealth Soldat before capturing SS Agent Henry Oswald, you see that he takes the fire. And you see all of your attention drawn to that as an impetus to escape. Have failed to capture SS Agent Henry Oswald.
Sorry, gang.
Leaves out of the building. Your optional objective here is thwarted. So you still have, you can now storm and destroy the rest of this building. And you can also power up the weapons platform if you like it. But Henry Oswald is no more.
I'd like to try and power up the weapons platform.
That's great. That's going to be
use fix.
Absolutely, you can, and that is objective level 5.
I'm going to mark one of my tool belt. Would this count as a jerry rigging?
Yeah, because you don't know this tech. Right. You're absolutely trying to jerry rig this tech.
Can you mark multiple things on your?
Yeah, go for it.
Oh yeah, let's do it. I'm going to do 3 plus jerry rigging plus 1 says 4, and I have a fix of 4 says 8.
You do it entirely. And you can, I would say,
I haven't rolled yet.
You haven't. Well, that's 8 dice.
I'm rolling 8.
I understand. I thought you had 8 successes. I was like, Jesus, that's a two. You two-shotted this entire encounter. Jesus.
Well, let's see what happens.
Jesus was also a vampire, according to the canon here. So,
Jesus. Yeah. I have three dice that are successes, but they're all sixes. So that's six successes.
So you see, as Chuck, as you kind of move over to this quadrupedal weapons platform, you manage to take your tools and you kind of open up the fuse box, kind of connect a bunch of things around. You got a half a wire in your mouth and you stuck a wrench in there and you're just moving it around. And you see this weapons platform comes to life and it looks like it can walk.
I think one of the things he does is, like, as he's in the middle of trying to fix it, he's like, oh, I need to connect these two points. And he actually just, like, puts his hand down and just, like, rips off one of his own fingers and, like, sticks it between the two points to make the connection.
I absolutely love that. I absolutely love that. So you do so, and now you have access to a quadrupedal weapons platform. You have four uses of that, and you get a plus one for shrug off incoming fire. So it will act for you essentially as its own little, like, turret that you can then kind of walk around and start destroying Nazis for you.
Yeah, perfect.
Four uses of that. Okay, so you still have, you can go ahead.
I'll take a spin at destroying this situation.
You've only got two successes left on that there. So go
amazing.
For it.
Conrad Cosgrave is going to find just some of the brilliant weaponry that they've got on display and just start hooking it up to the various other bits and pieces. Oh, wow. Wow, wow, wow. That's two sixes. So as he's like setting this up, he's like, okay, you know, taking these explosives, putting it over here. And then he just looks at this big dead cyborg.
Yeah.
And he goes, oh, I'm just a little snack. Just a little snack. Because we only need two successes to shut this thing down, right?
Yes, correct. Yes.
Yeah. So, he's going to, he's going to.
That's a spicy snack though.
And do you still do you drink Stelfel that?
Well, I haven't marked blood yet, but I will bottle some of that vintage.
Do you taste it?
Yeah, of course. Let's do it.
Okay.
Let's see whatever that does.
So as you sink your fangs, you clear the rest of this and you watch as you set off this chain reaction of dominoes, kind of like everything around starts to light up. And as you sink your fangs into Stelseldot, you realize that its blood tastes different than other human blood. It tastes like bleach, pine tar, and petrol. But you have four blood, and you can either keep all of that yourself or distribute it to everyone else.
Just the two blood.
You just want to take two blood? Okay, great.
Because two successes to blow up the thing.
That's right. So there will be two, if someone wants to roll roll for blood, if anyone needs blood, you can come and attempt to take two of them.
I'd love one.
I would love a blood also.
Great. So you can, I would say you can roll. At this point, like, we're entirely cleared. You cleared it all out. So you can take that two blood for free there. So as you're coming out, I would say you also see on, because you guys cleared this so effectively, I'm just going to give this to you because it's fun. Iryna, you've been keeping your eyes around for things like tanks.
Yes.
And while you do not see a tank here, you see something that would be really, really good if someone had a tank against you. You see a mountable bazooka turret that you could put on top of a tank. So you can carry, and I think Nicole might like this as well, you can carry the bazooka turret. It has two shots in it, but you do get a plus three to anti-tank.
Nicole, darling, I found a little present for you that I think you will enjoy very much.
That's exactly what I was looking for.
I toss it.
Yeah. Amazing. All right.
Accepts it.
So
I don't know why everyone was making such a big deal of this. This was very easy.
To be fair, yes. This one was very easy.
Hey, I gingerly step over the corpse.
I have a question for you.
Yeah, you have a question.
So now that I have a blood.
Yeah.
And I still have that ability called Blood Hunt. Where I can track a target, particularly if they're fleeing.
Yes,
Can we go try and find our little SS man?
You absolutely can. I will say you can use that ability and you start to run. The six of you run down the tunnels. You smell his sweat. You smell his fear as you are much faster than him. I'm going to say that now, because you've used a special ability for it, I'm going to say our original objective is back in play. This is an objective level 6. So for folks who have not already gone, I'm say Astrid, if you want to roll your turn here to use that as part of your turn, mm-hmm. you can absolutely do that. But for the folks who haven't acted, if you do not get him by the end of the time that everyone has acted, he will get away.
Oh boy.
Ooh, tense. Okay. So what do I
I'm
going to
say you can probably
this?
Roll a search.
Okay. And then you'll
this.
Get +2 because of your yeah. blood hunt thing.
There's only one plus by it. Do I?
I think it's plus for the ability and then plus if they are fleeing.
Yes.
Oh,
dude,
nice.
You can like find things better, and then if they're fleeing, it's even better than that.
Okay, so search is that one. I need one more. What a good day. Okay, that is
this is good metal, but also maybe spooky necromancer vibes.
That is 2 successes. I got a 4 and a 5.
Amazing. So you start well on the track towards Agent Henry Oswald. You see drips of blood on the floor, that he is bleeding. You can tell that he's probably not in really good shape. He looks to be like, if you see his foot patterns kind of like the skids on the floor, you're a fantastic tracker. You know what you're looking for. You see that he's likely limping, perhaps that he got into a bit of a tussle with Stal Soldat. He didn't know what he was doing. He was sent here to flick on this device and is fleeing for his fucking life. So who's left to go in this round? Because we've still got an objective level 4, and if you do not get him, he will get away. Because he's a sniveling little snot who defected.
Yeah. We don't want him. Nicole is going to throw a smoke grenade to try to like just disorient him. I have 5, 6, and a 4. So
yeah, incredible.
Yeah. I also, when I use explosives, I reduce an objective or a threat's challenge by 1.
Ooh. Amazing. You actually clear this entire objective in 1 shot here, Nicole. Oh, as you throw this smoke grenade down the hallway, it bang, 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 it banks off of the walls, and you hear it hit someone, and then it explodes, and you hear the slump of someone to the floor. And you just hear, please, please don't hurt me. Please don't hurt me. As you seem to have at least disabled him, and he is there. He doesn't seem to be moving, but he is awake, if you would like to go talk to him.
Oswald, as you, darling.
The smoke starts to clear as you see just a thin, reedy man with like greasy skin, greased hair, small spectacles on his nose, wearing a black suit, SS armband, with a distinctly British accent. Please,
Nicole
please,
goes I'm, and like Nicole goes and like just restrains him.
He doesn't like, fight roughly. It. He knows exactly who you are, and that you're much bigger than him and could rip his arms off if you wanted to. He does not fight it in the slightest.
For vibes, as we're walking up, I like kind of put my finger through some of the blood that has dripped on the wall or something as we're running through this tunnel. I just like making eye contact with this man on the floor.
Yeah. Incredible. He is terrified. Like, he is like, will pee his pants at a moment's notice. He is so scared. He knows exactly what he's done. And he's cowering. He has no spine and is a sniveling little wretch. And he looks up at you.
Oswald,
look,
darling,
I can
you
help
will
you.
Help us. Yes.
I can help you. Absolutely. I'll do whatever you want. I'll do whatever you want.
Good. What is there to be expected as we push forward?
Stal Soldat was the first one. Hitler wanted him out. I don't know its name other than it was just a soldier. The tag said 6317. That's all I know about it. I was just sent here to turn it on. The Rust Witch is in the Jardin. She's unpredictable. So we've just kind of given her free rein of the park until we can release her. Your weapons won't work on her, and good luck getting any car over there. So,
what do you mean our weapons won't work?
She takes things and she can move them and break them.
What would work on something like this Rust Witch?
I don't know. I didn't make her.
Oh, Oswald, you're so quickly becoming less useful to us.
Look, you know that there was, I see in your eyes, you knew about Rustwitch and you know about the one you know about Werhund.
Don't tell me what I do and do not know.
I'm just trying to be helpful. I'm trying to be helpful. Hmm. Please.
Where is, where do they keep the cars? I was told there were some, cars we could use.
There's a garage across the street. I haven't seen any tanks, but there might be a disabled one at the Jardin. The people have been rolling by to try and contain the witch, but they can't. So if you can figure it out and get the tank out of there, you could probably do it.
The witch has gone rogue.
Well, she's having fun in the park, it seems.
Killing Germans, killing Nazis.
She'll kill whoever, really. Mm. She's having fun, particularly bringing down the planes. She seems to like doing that. There is also one more you should be aware of. It's in the concert hall. Vogel was very willing to accept the program, but it did not have the effects that we intended. So, and the Führer stopped attending his performances, and we've had to lock him inside. He's a bit testy and very mercurial. We have plans to kind of just release them all tomorrow night.
My wonderful darlings, remind me, what was the objective around this sniveling little puller?
I believe it was to kill him.
Hmm.
I did have one more thing I needed to...
What? Anything, I'll tell you anything.
I had something to tell you.
Oh.
You have a gal back home, don't you?
His eyes go wide. His eyes go absolutely wide.
No. No, I've been in Germany for the last 6 months. So, no, weird. I don't have anybody back home.
Not what Zigzag told me.
Oh, if he could be, like, sick with just a look, you have hit a nerve here, touching on a part of his past that he did not ever want to have come up again.
Zigzag told me, let you know that he's going to take her dancing when he gets back.
He wouldn't dare.
He looks quite desperate, and he looks up and he goes, you need me.
There is one last thing left.
No. Left. You need me to get
more
into the broadcast. Tie,
darling, and I'm going to through his, just like a long fingernail through the bottom of his throat.
Okay.
Dinner is served, darlings.
As he's choking out, he just says, broadcast suite. You need me to get into the broadcast suite. As he starts to bleed out. Anybody drinking?
Why do we need you for the broadcast suite?
Nope, he has bled out. That is a long fingernail. So you can probably take, there's two blood in this sniveling little man. So if anybody needs any blood.
Astrid, darling, can you bring his body to the broadcast suite? Maybe.
Search him, see if he has any keys.
Yes, good.
I'm gonna take one of them two bloods.
I would love to take a blood. I'm out again.
Fantastic. Yeah, go for it. You got it. Yep. Okay.
I have a cigarette to give me blood.
Welcome in all these wonderful raiders. Thank you so much for being here. We're killing Nazis. Please join my voracious vampires. We're having a delightful time. Thank you so much for being here.
I'm sorry, darlings. I thought it was time for eating, not time for talking, but apparently he had more to say.
I'm going to give him a search, see if there's anything on him.
Hey, you can roll search.
Can I help to add a dice on that, or is that...
Sure. Yeah, I was thinking that.
I'll just
this is
help.
A dead body. You got all the time in the world.
Yeah. Flint comes down three successes. From.
Okay. Go ahead, Flint, and I'll resolve the three successes that you got there.
Oh, yeah. So Flint comes down from the rafters after, you know, sort of doing the scouting and stuff like that, sees all the dead Nazis and immediately begins to, like, sort of whine and sort of lick some of the blood off the floor, having missed out on the carnage. He is still super hungry. As he starts to just look around, sniffing for any surviving Nazis.
Okay. Your scent leads you out of the building. You hear that the shutters are, like, completely lifting up, and you seem to have full pass out of the building. So you break outside. Do you take
Oswald's body with you?
Absolutely.
Fantastic. So you can put down Lieutenant, or sorry, Special Agent Henry Oswald if you want
to
use him.
Equipment?
Yeah, you can add it to your equipment if you want to use him as a projectile or something to hit
with.
My God, he's probably got two uses out of him.
Don't throw
plus one to terrify.
You have London's foremost necromancer among you. If we need him to get us into the broadcast suite, he may still be useful.
Well, we have two uses of it, so.
You have two uses of the former SS agent Henry Oswald. Okay, so you exit out of the pavilion and you see quite an expensive looking garage across the street, and you make a break for it. So you crash in through the door, and you know that few people owned a car in 1940s Paris, and for most of that date, it was a status symbol. As you crash through the front door and the window, you see that most of the vehicles in this garage belong to German expats or diplomats who want to be seen driving something expensive. They can't handle much from punishment from enemy fire, but on an open road, they can achieve a fair lick of speed. So you got a new objective here, steal something flashy and get the hell out of here, which is objective level 8. Objective level 8 gets you two cars. So there are, and some of these will need to be a fix to like hotwire or get rid of these in some capacity. And you can let me know if you would like to see what cars are in front of you.
Yeah, I think I should probably take a first pass at this. What have I got in front of me?
All right, you see an open-topped Italian speedster that has two uses and a plus two to stunts. You see a reliable German import, two uses and a plus two to tight turns. And you have an unremarkable French jalopy, two uses and a plus two to go unnoticed.
Yeah, I'm going to take the first one with a stunt.
Absolutely.
I'm big into stunts.
Okay, so to get one of these going, you're going to need four successes.
I want to see if, hey, Nicole, you want to see if we can fit that anti-tank thing on top of the car?
Aye, she should fit. To finagle it.
Absolutely. I want to build it in there.
And you can add a plus for jerry-rigging to that. I'll save for that.
Perfect.
Well, which of these three is the nicest looking car?
Definitely the one that
has a backseat.
Oh, I would say the reliable German import.
Right.
So I'm going to, that's a plus two, six total.
Six, amazing.
Hold on, six dice I get to roll.
Six dice.
To clarify.
Six successes. I'm like, oh my God, just clearing everything so fast.
It's too many dice.
Can we get blood from the vehicle?
Yeah, suck that car oil.
They're bloody. Delicious.
Oil's just car blood.
Easy.
The Volkswagen is, or the old jalopy is just filled with corpses for some reason.
Delicious corpses. Car of a thousand corpses.
Belonged to a group of clowns and they all died together.
They all died together in the car.
Three successes.
Very sad, but good for us.
Fantastic. So you have this open-topped Italian speedster. Looks like it is almost ready to go for you. However, as you start to hotwire these cars, you hear more windows shattering that you did not do as the sound of a smaller concealed sniper team on an adjacent roof starts firing at you. You hear spotters calling out your positions in German. So right now, your objective is steal cars would be, what, five at this point?
Yeah.
The sniper team is a threat level 2, but their attack is 6, and their challenge rating is only a 1. So it is less difficult. They are a smaller team, but they still hit really, really hard.
Oh, quick question for you before my turn's done. My quadrupedal weapons platform, can I send that off to deal with the snappers?
You absolutely can. So you activate this weapons platform. You see that it does have a fuel canister on it, though.
I look over at Astrid. You want to save it for the cars or you want to save it for this? It's up to you.
Astrid will pull out one of the little vials and will sort of swill it around, pop it. Taste it first and then pour it into that bad boy.
It tastes kind of like chocolate.
Ooh.
So, okay, so you have the
is it just chocolate?
You don't know. You didn't taste it.
Just fully glommed on the system. It's fucked now.
You didn't taste it. Okay, so you can
honestly,
add...
I'm fueled by chocolate, so I get it.
So I'm going to have you... So you send this weapons platform outside. I'm going to say it has a shoot three. Mm-hmm. You can add a +1 because of the prototype fuel. And you only have one use of that prototype fuel left.
All right, I have four uses, right?
Does it get another +1 because of the taste?
How
does the tasting at first plus...
It adds an extra +1, so yes, it would get +2.
I know how to just pour it in there a little better, because I'm like...
Can I burn all four uses?
Of the weapons charge?
Of the quadrupedal.
Yeah.
As in, like, add 4 die and then just have it explode?
I would say, let's roll that... That's what it is. It is experimental fuel. Because it's only a threat level 2, so you might clear it. Like, you need, technically, you need 5, 6. So you could clear this, like, with the turret, like, all in one round.
Okay.
So it's technically you're rolling 5 dice. Yeah.
How do specials work? Like, your special abilities, are they, like, a one-time thing?
If it's Mark Blood, you can use that as many times as you like, as you have blood. If it does not say Mark Blood, you get that once per session.
Gotcha. Okay.
So I rolled 5 dice.
Yes.
So I just used one single one. As per your suggestion, I rolled a 4, a 5, a 5, a 5, and a 6.
Yeah.
So,
Jesus
that's
Christ.
Six successes.
So, Flint, you see Astrid kind of like give this fuel a taste, pour it inside the tank, and you see it kind of shoot around this weapon platform as like the pistons and it is up. It goes outside. You see like 2 guns raise out of it and just start like it almost looks like there's scopes. You see lasers come out of it, maybe heat seeking, and you just hear bah, 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 as just a barrage of fire, and you see 3 bodies fall off the building immediately. You've cleared that sniper team. Congratulations. Well done.
Yeah. Woof.
Nice. You guys are very powerful.
Good golly.
Okay, great.
With the sniper team dealt with, I would like to sit in the back seat right in the middle of the reliable German export. And that would be my turn.
You're not going to help at all?
That's beneath me.
Okay.
I'm Eastern European aristocracy.
Conrad will get into the front of the fucking German export and just get elbow deep in that fucking thing and try to jerry-rig it.
Absolutely, go ahead.
He'll fucking use his enormous knife to fucking
get elbow deep in the box. It. Yeah,
yeah, you know, just add an extra die to the fix here. There we go. That's 3 successes. Is that going to get us where we're going?
That is going to get you. You have almost got it. Each of these has 1 success left on them. So if somebody else wants to come in there and give the assist, we've got, anybody else want to give the assist?
I got one more fuel source going, so I feel like might as well.
Have you had a turn this round?
I have not. I don't think so.
Go ahead. Then what would you like to do?
Okay. So yeah, I'm going to walk up and see that it's mostly in fighting shape, but that it just needs a little more pep in its step. So I'm going to actually offer a sip to Cosgrave to see if Cosgrave would like to do the honors of tasting this.
Cosgrave will absolutely partake in the mystery fluid.
Incredible.
To you, Cosgrave, I think it tastes like the first fresh sip of a gin and tonic.
Well, this is like Felix Felicis.
And down the hatch it goes.
Amazing. So yeah, you can roll, I would say Astrid, you can roll a fix.
Okay.
And you can add the +2 for the prototype fuel source, and you have completely used that prototype fuel source.
Yep. Okay. That is a 4 and a 6.
Amazing. So you know what you actually do, Astrid, as you are starting, you know that Cosgrave will have a handle on this car now that he's had kind of a taste of the fuel. You'll see he goes and pours the fuel in the tank and the car starts to life, and you run over and you kind of just kick the Italian speedster, putting a dent in the front of it, but it does start for you. So you have now started these 2 vehicles and everybody piles in. Who is in which car?
Chuck's driving the stunt
speedster. Yeah, incredible.
I'm excited for some stunts.
Iryna is in the back seat of the reliable German import with Cosgrave up front. And where are the rest of you?
Nicole will ride passenger side with Chuck.
Amazing.
I don't fucking drive.
So. Neither do I, darling.
Jesus, strong opinions about driving.
I think that Flint and Astrid, where are you at?
I think Astrid is gonna shoulder Cosgrave into the passenger seat, and she's gonna drive.
Oh, Jesus Christ! I get into the other car. I don't like this fucking car.
No, I mean, I literally can't drive, so someone else has to.
Is the Chuck and Nicole car two-seater?
I would say you could probably put three people in.
Cosgrave is sitting on Nicole's lap.
There's the lap.
Yeah, that sounds nice for me.
It's bench seating, right? So I would say at this point it's bench seating in the front.
He's sitting, and every time I shift the gear, it's like right between his legs.
The sexual tension is incredible. With Chuck,
Flint, you're not going to believe this, but I'm a eunuch.
I go. Flint, darling, you can ride in the shotgun seat or on the roof if you want. It's up to you.
Hearing a whistle, I'm imagining that Flint, for the first, like seeing the three sniper bodies landing on the ground, Flint's already rushed over there and currently just has these three bodies like sort of just digging into them with his tusks and fangs.
I'll give you three free blood for that because you're the only person who dealt with a sniper body. So you can have the three free blood there, my friend.
Huzzah!
I throw Oswald into the back seat next to Iryna.
Yeah,
Flint,
cool.
Darling, take one down as a walk me down. Come on.
I've got one of the bodies with me as I just basically trot, dripping this trail of gore and viscera.
It's fast
but
food.
It's only,
I love it.
But it's only the torso of one of these snipers. The entrails are sort of trailing behind me as I jump onto the roof of the German car. I use my claws and... Actually, you know what? No. Does the German car have a hood?
Yeah.
No, not anymore. As I rip it and turn it into a convertible... Yes. And then just sort of place myself kind of almost in a protective pose over the back seat with my wings stretched out like a canopy.
I'm
going to kind of...
Out of hell vibes from a meatloaf cover.
That was the vibe.
Flint, darling, please block the winds. No roof, it'll ruin my hair.
You watch as Flint just sort of lowers into more of a prowling position with the wings kind of...
You start off down the street, and as you peel out, heading towards the Jardin de Fay, which you know is probably going to be about a 25-minute drive through the city, you hear the sound of another car screeching behind you around the corner as you have an armored car giving chase after you. It's a steel-armored wheeled troop transport with a machine gun bolted on the top. Your threat level here is 4, your attack is 2, and challenge rating is 1. What would you like to do here? We can start the top of a new round.
Nicole, you got this one.
That's right. And Nicole takes out their machine gun and like leans outside of the passenger window. And I'm gonna roll for that because it also has
sight so plus for long distance. And if you hold your breath, you can get a plus.
Who has the bazooka right now? Where is the bazooka positioned?
The bazooka is on top of their car.
Okay, great.
I have a 3 success.
Incredible. So the challenge rating 1, that'll knock down 2 off the success of this armored car. As you see Nicole just kind of like, this is truly what Nicole has trained for. Mm-hmm. They lean their body kind of up and out of the car. It is one of the most graceful movements. You see them hook a leg over the back, like the back of the bumper, just to really make sure that they're not going to fall out. And you just hear the ra-da-da-da-da of like machine gun fire. And you watch as 4 of the soldiers just fall off the top of the car. And you see that the machine gun has been damaged. Well done. Fantastic.
And they're just
work.
Laughing maniacally.
Actually,
like,
you know
this
what?
I'm sorry.
I have to roll my attack. I forgot to do that. I wanted to give that to you so bad. And I rolled a 1 and a 3. So, yes, you do all of that stuff and you still knock it down by 2. Well done. Yeah, super. It's so hot. Like, Jesus Christ. Like, it's too much. And okay, so who is next? Who is next to deal with this armored car threat?
So, as the cars are veering. And moving through the various streets of Paris. As we turn around a corner, Flint sees there's like one of the nearby street lights as we veer around a corner and almost like to kind of assist with the turn and at the same time tear it down. I'm going to use my steel gouging claw to reach around the side, just scraping into the streetlight to bring it crashing down along the bonnet of the armored car.
Incredible.
As we drive
go
past.
For it. I'm going to roll my attack here for you as they fire on you with what's left of their machine gun. And I rolled so poorly. I rolled a 2 and a 3. God damn it. I just want some Nazis to hit you. I don't want that. I want you to kill them all. But like.
All right. They are not happy. That is 6 successes.
Jeez. So, okay. Oh. So you clear this. So as this kind of this. Oh my God, this light post just kind of crashes down on the inside of the car. You see, it's just as they were about to fire like a larger rocket at you and it gets stuck and gets stuck in the barrel of the bazooka launcher on top of their armored car and it explodes the armored car and you just have a flaming, broken, busted armored car of dead Nazis. Well done.
Hell okay. Yeah.
So you speed aloft down in the direction of the Jardin de Fay, but your joyride is interrupted as you see a plot of land next to what looks to be an art gallery or a museum that is absolutely alight with flame. This is not on your map, but do you want to swing by and investigate or do you want to continue towards the Jardin de Fay?
Let's check it out.
Yeah, let's check it out.
My house needs some new decor, so I would love to go by.
Amazing. So you peel the cars off and you manage to screech out as you barrel your way inside. You burst through the front of this museum and it seems that this is a collection of art that the Reich has found antithetical to Nazi values. Hitler, as you know, was an unsuccessful artist who was denied entry to the Vienna Academy of Fine Arts. True fact. And was apparently decided to take out on the entire European continent.
His perspective and angle work was really bad.
No kidding.
It's like genuinely shit. You see a painting of his and it's like all the corners are fucked.
It's so bad. So all
because
he
could only do
here...
right wings. Just continue.
Okay, get out of here. All of the art in here has been deliberately badly framed and hung and is surrounded with mocking commentary. This is actually what used to happen in they called them degenerate art museums. You assume that most of the really good pieces in here have been snapped up by Nazi officers for their private collections because they actually knew how much it was worth, and the remainder are being burned in the adjoining gardens of all of these museums on a regular basis. Tonight, in fact, seems to mark one of the largest burnings of art on record, and now unattended flames are spiraling up towards the night sky. You're pretty sure that anyone for an eye for art in here could uncover a lost masterpiece, maybe a Van Gogh, a Picasso, or another European luminary, but getting them out of Paris intact won't be easy. So your objective here is quite simple. Undertake a very quick and violent art gallery tour with an objective level 8. Your secondary objective is a level 4 and says track down a lost Van Gogh or something. This is actually from the book. I didn't make this up. It's incredible. And it says in here, completing this objective nets you no mechanical benefit, but you might have found a lost Van Gogh. You can flog it for cash or hang it up in your next castle. So you see a lot of the typical classics in here, but you also see a lot of Dadaism and Surrealism. This metal is so intense for an art gallery.
You want me to mix it up? Should I mix it up?
This is it. This is it.
Okay, violent. You said violent art tour. So.
It's a violent art tour.
I can't wait to mow Nazis down in this car.
The Nazis consider most European art the product of 20th century decadence, and apparently that's not okay. So
that's my whole brand.
I'd like to take my car into the gallery, please.
Yeah, incredible. Crash your car into the gallery. Roll. Yeah. You can roll a drive or like a fix. You can roll fixed.
I feel like this is stunts, right?
I would say plus to stunts.
That's two.
Do I get
plus two for stunts? Do I get plus two for stunts? Absolutely.
What is the reliable German import get bonuses to? What was that again?
Is that the turning. Tight corner?
It was the turning.
Turning. Okay.
That's 4 successes.
Fantastic. So you burst through into the gallery, truly starting off the violent art tour quite well. You are now driving a car inside an art gallery. Fantastic.
A burning art gallery.
Yes.
Yeah. Yeah, that's my turn. Now I'm
incredible.
I'll say Cosgrave, Nicole. I don't know, find a Van Gogh or something. I don't know.
Yes, absolutely. And Cosgrave, who abhors the destruction of art, is going to. He knows he's here to kill Nazis and Ubermensch and stuff, yes. But the idea of burning an art gallery offends. Like, people die, but art lasts forever.
Yes.
And he's going to reach into his jacket and pull out that little jar with a little piece of cloth gotten over it. And it just says on the bottom, MM, which stands for Mother Millicent. And he is going to open it up. And this is the jar belonging to just the most holy person in the history of the Fang organization. And when Cosgrave was asking that nun about whether she believed in good or bad, he was just curious because he has evidence that good exists, and he keeps it on his person as he just opens it up and he just whispers, "Save it all." And just this spirit of this nun.
Yeah.
If there's one thing that Cosgrave is good at, it's bottling ghosts.
Yes.
And
you're very good at distilling them. Yes.
Yeah. And so he is going to huff the last of his ghosts and release the spirit of what would be essentially a saint if the Catholic Church wasn't such a patriarchy. And he's just going to be like reaching through and grabbing every piece of art, whether or not there's a Van Gogh or not. Anything that's burning, it's going into the back.
Incredible. I'm going to have you roll a search and you can add all of those.
I'm
pluses.
Also going to.
Mother Millicent is like a plus over, 4, isn't
I'm
it?
Gonna, yep. lean, anything.
I'm going to lean over and give him a little hit, a little bump while he's at it.
Yeah. You can have a little bump.
Oh, no, it is. It's plus 4 because using it, and then it's plus 3 for any reason.
Yes.
Also, Bottling Ghosts is my favorite Death Cab for Cutie song.
This is 10d6, team.
Holy
Jesus,
shit.
Murphy.
Cosgrave cannot abide by art destruction.
sick.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8.
8 successes.
Sorry, 6. Just 6.
Wow.
No 6s in there?
I got 2 6s.
Oh, nice.
2 5s.
Well, wouldn't you know that there are 6... prolific pieces of art right in front of you here. So as this spirit rolls through you, it is almost like it's pointing you to all of the art that really desperately for the sake of humanity and like European culture needs to be saved. You find Raphael's portrait of a young man. It looks exactly as what you think it looks like. You find Vincent van Gogh's Painter on His Way to Work. It's a Van Gogh. It makes you want to cry with how beautiful it is. You find Edgar Degas' The Dancing Women. It's a bunch of pretty ladies doing ballet. You find Hieronymus Bosch's The Garden of Earthly Delights. Hieronymus Bosch was doing weird shit way before it was cool. There's like a bunch of weird little guys running around. It feels vaguely religious. It looks like a Renaissance acid trip, and this was painted in the 1500s.
Rad.
You find Paul Klee's L'Homme Approximatif, which is a weird group of lines that looks like a face that's been taken apart and splayed out. Definitely a work of surrealism. And then you find Marcel Duchamp's Fountain, which is one of the quintessential pieces of Dadaism. That is a urinal that is turned on its side. And that's exactly what it is in its art.
Cosgrave isn't sure about that one. It's sort of a new school thing, but you know, he's already saved it. He's not going to throw it out, is he?
Hedging his bets.
So you have 6 pieces of all of these pieces, all of the Dadaism and Surrealism pieces. All of these are still considered lost Nazi pieces of art.
Okay.
I went and did a lot of deep digging, y'all. So you have 6 pieces of art now.
Also, there is a ton of conspiracy theories around Garden of Earthly Delight. There's like a lot to delve into there. If you're like,
unpack.
If you want to look at a piece of art and be like, "Ooh, there's a thing I've noticed," that's a good one.
Yes. All right. So you have only 2 more two more levels of your objective to complete. Cosgrave, as you're kind of pulling through the last of the art pieces, you see kick through a wall that's already on fire. You see 4 essentially Nazi. Soldiers holding flamethrowers. This is the art burning brigade, and they're here to put fire on you folks. So we have a threat level 4 with an attack 4. So you've got still violent art gallery visit 2, threat, and then a threat level 4 for this art burning brigade.
Wonderful. Some people to help me carry my paintings.
I would like to step forward. And would you say an art gallery is beautiful surroundings?
I absolutely would. This one, not really, but the art is beautiful.
I'm going to mark blood then as I use my... It's a thing. Dark glamour.
Yes.
As I step forward and I get a little more unearthly beautiful.
It's not like... possible, but yet you still are more beautiful.
Yeah, I know, right? I'm going to be like... Darlings, why destroy such wonderful art when you can pile them in a car and you never need to see them again? And I would like to roll con, and mesmerize these people.
Fantastic.
Con. So I'm going to.
I'm going to roll the attack level this 4 to see if you get that off before they hit you.
Yeah, this is beautiful surroundings.
Oh boy. I got 5 successes there, my friend.
Woo!
Oh boy,
you gotta clear those first before you do
anything. I'm probably
gonna
take some wounds. Or I could roll a number of sixes. Holy.
Never mind.
Won't be
over here.
Fuck. All right. Six. 1, 2. 4s are successes, right?
4s are successes, 3, yes.
4. 4s and 5s.
Yes.
And 2 6s.
Fantastic. So you knock this art burning brigade. It's 8. You have 8 successes.
8 successes total.
Okay. So you, So as you say this towards this art burning brigade, you see as they kind of turn off their flamethrowers and they look at the art and they look back at you and they go, yeah. And they just start loading the unburned art into the trunk of your reliable German import.
Yeah.
And you have 4. You can drink them. You can do whatever
you
want. Yeah,
so I had to drop 5.
Yes.
And then I had 2 left.
Mm-hmm.
So I have 1. I'm going to drink 1.
Yeah, great. Go for it. So threat
but
level
leave,
is...
leave them alive so that they can carry my...
Because the threat level is down to 2, but I would still consider them mesmerized for you. So if someone doesn't do something by there's no really mechanics around your mesmerizing, you know what I mean?
No, not really, yeah.
So if someone doesn't do something to them by the end of this round, they'll probably break out of it.
Right, of course.
But now they are loading art into your car. Also, Nicole, gosh, what a lovely flamethrower that is on the ground.
Isn't that nice? They've just been
so nice.
Admiring that. And
there's also
2
of them, if someone else would like one.
Oh, yeah, I'm definitely going to pocket one of those.
What if, here's my pitch, what if one person gets 2 Nicole double-handed flamethrowers? That sounds pretty cool. Anyone done flamethrower akimbo style?
Yeah.
So
can I take 2?
You can take 2 if you want to. Okay, hell yeah.
So dangerous with the 2 gas canisters on the back.
Flamethrowers have 4 uses, and you get a +2 if you add extra accelerant onto them.
Okay.
We have that. Like we have that. No, we use the last of it.
We use it the last of it.
Oh,
but
I do feel like having another flamethrower is kind of an accelerant.
Can you flamethrower a flamethrower? Can you flameception a flamethrower?
Yes.
The dragon riding a dragon.
Absolutely. Okay.
I am going to take a shot at the mesmerized guys, though.
Yeah.
With my sniper. So I'm in close quarters.
Yeah, absolutely.
Or my rifle, rather, not sniper. Okay, so I just have a 2 success.
Okay, great. So I'm gonna roll to see if they break out of it. I almost feel like I should roll at disadvantage. I don't know.
Because they're so mesmerized.
I rolled a 3 and a 1. I'm rolling like trash garbage tonight. So yeah, you take a shot and you clear that right out. This art burning brigade is absolutely done. You have 2 flamethrowers. You are doing so well tonight.
Nicole is thriving.
Any
Nicole
of them
thriving
the
right
like left over, even if they're just like dying on the ground, I'm like, go crawl into the fire with their packs on. Just like,
oh
go.
Boy, they start doing that. Yep, they start doing that because they're still mesmerized.
Darlings, time to leave.
Oh my.
We have done such a wonderful job today.
Crawl into the fire.
We don't stay to watch that happen. We leave. We leave before we see any of that. We pull you back into the cars and you hop back in and you start screeching towards the Jardin de Fay.
I'd like to stunt.
Yeah,
I don't know
do
what
that.
That is, but I'd like
you can
to
roll
a
I would like to
do
that.
Excuse me, ma'am. I'd like to stunt.
I'd like to.
You're not
going to
fail at it.
The
but...
inspiration for Vin Diesel's hit Fast and the Furious movies in the future.
Yeah,
like, I want
absolutely.
This.
Incredible. I'm going to get you to roll a fix, and you can add the plus for stunts. I just want to see how well you do this. You're gonna do it.
What am I rolling?
A fix. We've determined that driving is fixed.
Yeah.
From episode
car
one.
Car stuff.
That was really bad. Only one success.
I mean, you drive.
Oh, perfect.
I mean, there's no recorded record of what this looks like, so maybe somewhere someone along the line will be inspired by this, but they may never know about it. But you drive really well. You're a good
just
driver.
Just a bold man standing in the shadows of burning Paris that goes, family.
Exactly.
Look at that
so
family.
You hop in the back of, you hop back in and you screech down towards the Jardin de Fay. As you drive up, can you change the tone of this music, Adam, to something weird? I don't know. Wonky carnival something music would probably weird. Be the best. No.
Carnival music. I love that choice. That delights me.
What about the one that goes like,
No, not that one.
I'm just going to say, my life is going to be complete if I manage to eat a Nazi dressed as a clown and ask if it tastes funny.
Yes, amazing. So this wonky carnival music is mixed in with the sound of grinding of metal on metal and screaming. While it first looks like doesn't seem to be anyone inside the fairgrounds, all of the lights and the machinery have been left on and seem to be running of their own accord. This is a Nazi-built amusement arcade and illumination grounds. It's like a pretty garden with a couple Ferris-like attractions. It's popular with young soldiers who are trying to take their darlings on a cheap date. The crowning glory of the park, however, is Europe's third largest Ferris wheel. A variety of carnival games, carousels, and light-ups displays to do plenty around the rest of the fair. As you get closer, however, you start to screech in to the Jardin de Fay, and your car grinds to a halt. You hear the engine stop working, and you get the sense that the forces at work here are behind this. You roll out, and you start to enter the fairground. Your objective here is to get through the Jardin and find the blue carousel, which is an objective level 10.
Mm-hmm. Find the blue carousel. Got it.
Yes.
Or it's not working. Must be that rusty witch.
So you walk past the collapsing wrought iron fence. It's bent and it's twisted, reflecting the amusement park lights. Carrion birds spiral in senseless patterns above you. You see a completely useless tank that has been just abandoned by its crew just inside the large entrance. And as you look, falling out of the sky, a fighter pilot plane passes over.
No.
You watch the person eject out at the last minute as their plane, perfect, careens off somewhere in the distance. The propellers and the engines fully cut out. And you think that this might be what they have been talking about. You approach. Go ahead. Yeah, go ahead.
Right. Flint's gonna is the guy who's ejected gonna be all right? Like
super far off, so you cannot see them. You also can't discern whether it's German or British at this level. You have no idea.
Yep.
So yeah, welcome to the fair.
I hate this.
Broach the abandoned ticket booth, and then you see it. You see a small tank crew, also attempting to make their way through the fairgrounds after their tank cut out. But they're not even looking at you. They're staring at a woman riding the detached Ferris wheel right towards you.
Like a unicycle? Fuck yeah, dude.
It is unclear.
We don't have to kill her. That sounds awesome.
It's unclear what her body is composed of. As you see, any form of her skin is otherwise covered except for her face. It is cyanotic with bloodshot eyes, and she has a crown of spikes and nails and shrapnel emerging directly from her scalp. Her face is expressionless, this dead-eyed stare in front of her. The rest of her is shrouded in this deep teal jacket with rust red belted around her and otherwise obscuring her form. Her forearms are gold-plated Atlantean relics.
Wait, sorry, forearms or forearms?
She has four arms.
Oh,
I said.
And her fingers are narrowed into sharply pointed claws. And in her hands, she carries a bone-handled, barbed garrote.
Her hands are made of what?
gold-plated Atlantean relics.
Oh.
Yeah, this is directly from the canon. This is all canonical Rustwitch. So Rustwitch, who has had her true name surgically removed by a team of occultists, uses Golden Age technology harvested from Atlantean satellites to manipulate the forces of chance, entropy, and decay. Mm. Mm. Of all the Ubermensch in Paris, she will be the most difficult to control, as she has a penchant for wild chaos. You see her slightly extend her hands as she careens towards you, and you watch three other planes that you did not see from the sky above start to plummet. This raw entropic power harvested from catastrophes, feeding her and coursing through her blood. If she were to be let loose on Europe and leave this little playground that she is having so much fun in and focus her attention elsewhere, machines would malfunction, metal would rust, supports would snap, and failsafes would fail. She would leave pure, unbridled chaos in her wake.
Can I use my power Disbelieve in Atlantis to just...
Well, do we get a feeling that guns will still work?
You're going to have to try.
All right, what I would like to do is...
So I will list out the primary objectives for you first, just so you know what you're playing with. Your primary objective is to navigate the fairgrounds and the blue carousel, to find the blue carousel 10. You have to clear the Jardin and liberate Checkpoint Bravo. The Rust Witch's threat level is a 10. She has an attack level 6.
Fuck!
She also has what's called an aura of misfortune. You discard rolls on 1 to 4 rather than 1 to 3.
Oh.
And there are no reinforcements at the end of every round, but I will be rolling 1d6, and I will tell you what happens if we get there and you have not killed her in time. There is also this little tank crew that will probably fight for their lives and try and kill you in the name of Germany also.
Yeah, all right.
Gross.
Yeah, pretty gross.
I'm going to take off running towards her. She's still on the Ferris wheel?
She absolutely is, and she is careening towards you. You can hear her scream laughing. It is just like scream laughter, and you can't tell whether it's in pain or it's in joy.
I'm going to dodge around.
Yeah.
And I'm going to approach from behind, grab on, and as the Ferris wheel spins, I'm going to let it spin me up to her.
Okay.
And what I'm going to do is, if you'll allow it.
You can certainly always try.
I'm mark one blood.
Yes.
I have acid spit that gives +2 to metal, and I believe you said her forearms are made of gold.
Yeah, they sure are.
I'm going to spit all over damn forearms, and then I'm going to fire 4 explosive rounds right into her.
Yeah, absolutely. Fuck, you're gonna do that.
All right, so that is shoot 3.
Yes.
Explosive round is +2, so that's I'm shooting all 4.
Yes, absolutely.
So that's shoot 3, 4 +2 for each. That's 8, 11. And then acid is 2. So 13.
Yeah, absolutely. I will say here, your tank crew, because they are trained soldiers, also have a threat level of 8 and an attack of 3.
Okay, my roller apple only let me roll 10 at a time. So I'm going to roll the 10 and then I'll roll the... It's 13, I said, right?
You did.
13, yeah.
Yeah, so I'll roll 10 first. Oh, jeez. You said 4s don't count on her.
4s do not count. Only 5s and 6s.
Woof.
All right.
This is your final boss battle, y'all.
Two 5s and a 6 on the first 10, so 4.
Okay.
We're having 3 6s on these last 3.
And she also rolls an attack of 6, so I will be rolling that too.
Totally chill, not a problem. 4. I think everything here is good and fine.
She's fine to play in her little park, right?
That was 2 6s on the next one, so that's
okay.
8.
4 extra.
8 total.
All right, so she rolled 3 successes from her 6, so you have 5 successes to play with.
And she's a challenged...
10.
She's a threat level 10.
She's no challenge, though?
No challenge.
Ooh.
So I'll put 5 towards her.
Amazing.
Threat level. Yeah.
Incredible. So you watch as two, as you blow off these explosive rounds, hit and they impact right at the wrist on one and the elbow at the other. And she has lost. She still holds on to her bone garrote in the hand as she tries to loop it out at you, and you manage to duck out of the way as she was trying to pull that around. And
yeah, the way I sort of see it is as I come by, I spit the acid on her arms. Yes. And as it melts, I target the holes left behind with the exploding bullets.
Perfect. Love that. Okay. Who's next?
I think I just think that Astrid would be very incensed by the fact that there are a lot of planes going down. I think it's a little, yes. I think it hits a little too close to home for her.
Not the planes!
So I think that she, just filled with rage, I'm going to use my special ability Apex Predator as she charges toward, this is my like one whatever thing. So she's gonna charge towards the Ferris wheel, and actually like on her way up climbing is just gonna be destroying pieces of it. Yes. And I get to reduce a threat's rating by 3.
Oh hell yeah, just automatically.
So I'm just gonna do that.
Okay.
And then I don't know if that's my full turn or if I could like attack or whatever. I don't know.
I think
that's work.
I think it's the threat's attack rating, I believe.
No, it just says reduce a threat's rating by 3, so I don't know.
But yeah, that's incredible.
It's
all right.
She's down to 2. Specifically a threat and not like a challenge or anything like that.
You can still roll to brawl with her.
I would love
you
to do that.
You got to protect yourself from her attack.
Yes, and so she's going to roll with 6 dice against you.
That's fine.
As you see her become destabilized as she starts to wobble off the top of this Ferris wheel toward you.
Can I use my particularly huge cross and try to swing for the fences as I try to bat her off of this thing?
Yeah, you absolutely can.
Cool.
Oh boy.
So just to clarify again, if there's 2 pluses and then it has the words, that's 3 total things, right?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So 1, 2, 3 for that.
All right.
1, 2, 3 for that. Okay.
3, 4, 5, 6. So she rolled 6.
Okay.
6 successes. So you have to clear 6 successes first before you do anything.
Okay. I rolled, you said 6 successes?
Mm-hmm.
And 4s don't count, correct?
4s do not count.
Damn, that was such a good roll. Okay, I got 2 6s, so that's 4. I got a 5, so that's 5. But I also have this other ability that I'll just also use at this point in time called Unnatural Endurance. So I can reduce the GM's attack dice by 3. I don't know if I needed to do that before you rolled.
Probably, yeah, but I will only take,
You rolled 6 and were successful in all 6, so it basically brings it down to 3, right?
Yes.
Cool. Yeah. So I will do that and just kind of like entirely barrel through, like not even phased. And
so how many successes did you have?
That's 5, so that would be 3 to negate the attack.
So you have
then
2 successes.
2 left to swing this bitch off the top of a Ferris
Please
wheel.
Please tell me how you take the giant cross and you absolutely knock the Rust Witch off of her Ferris wheel. How do you do this?
So I think that it's sort of all in this like fluid motion of climbing up the Ferris wheel and taking out parts of it as she's going up and sort of just grabbing it and swinging it from underneath and knocking her upside the head as she just goes flying off the back of it.
Incredible. And you watch as she careens into one of the wrought iron fence posts. She is impaled on it. And you watch as she like slowly starts to bleed out. Oh, on the fence post as the Ferris wheel keeps running. And you have killed the Rust Witch. Absolutely.
Metal time again.
It was really good that you did that before the end of the round because everyone was going to have to roll 1d6 and one of your weapons would be destroyed by the end of the turn.
Oof.
So she is dead. However, you still have your Navigate the Fairgrounds 10 and you have this wonderful little tank crew that now seeing that the Rust Witch is dead have run over back to their tank and they have started their tank again.
So you're saying the tank is operational.
Yes, and you are not near your anti-tank thing because it is back near the cars at this point, which is in the far back. So you are not near with your anti-tank gun at this point.
I'm gonna have to give me some chance
to try and mess you up. Okay,
I'm gonna take my proton beam emitter, and point it right at the tank coming towards us.
Darling, no.
I have to do it.
Can you fix it later?
Do you calibrate it before firing it?
Yes, I do calibrate it.
Go for it.
I very deftly boop, beep, boop, beep, boop, calibrate.
Fantastic.
So okay, I'm going to roll the attack of 3 against you. A 2 sixes and a 5.
Sheesh!
That is 5 successes you're going to have to beat there.
Yikes.
Okay, I have 5 successes.
So you trade fire with this tank crew as you see them attempting to clamber back into their tank. You take a bullet in the shoulder, and you know that that's a non-lethal hit, and it does not cause you an injury, but you know you just managed to like parry with them. So no threat reduction there, but you avoided an injury.
Would you say the buildings around here are kind of old? This is like an old kind of fairground, right?
It is not. It is a new fairground that has been constructed by the Nazis.
These fucking Nazis making new stuff where I need old stuff.
Sorry.
Fucking dare they.
You've done so right? much damage to all of my Ubermensch, okay,
either
Adam.
Way, I did damage to one Ubermensch. I did nothing to the rest of it.
You didn't do damage. You just ended its life. There's a difference.
I'm going to Knight's Willing Servants. I am going to summon a swarm of bats under my control.
Mm-hmm.
I mark blood for that, so I will do that. As they come like rushing past me, I'm going to put my hand up in the air and a few of them are going to hit my hand and keep flying, grabbing something. I'm going to mark a usage of one of my items. I'm going to keep it secret for now because it'll be cool. Mm-hmm. As the bats fly towards the tank and they're trying to get like in the tank, literally like flying down the barrel of the tank, like flying all through the tank. And of the like 7 that hit my hand, one of them grabbed an explosive rune. Would you say that's argument for the explosive rune being concealed?
It's a bit of a stretch, but yeah, I'll give it to you.
Thank you.
I might not be so nice next time.
And
what a fucking cool GM.
Thank you.
I am going to roll not 13d6 because I'm not that cool.
Well, I did roll 3 sixes with my attack, so that's 6 sixes you're going to have to clear. So that's the payoff for that.
All right. Yeah, that's fair. That's fine. I'm able to shoot my gun at the same time, right?
Yeah.
Can I mark a usage of my gun? Sweet. Yeah. So I'll mark a use of that and that. Give me an extra dice.
So many dice y'all roll in. So we have yet to decrease the tank crew's threat. You've got threat 8, attack 3.
And the Rust Witch's thing on 4's no longer a thing.
No longer a thing.
Sick, because there's so many 4's in this pile, and I was going to be sad about it. There's 2 1s, so get rid of those.
I will also say that people can run over to Rust Witch, and you can drink her blood, too. 7, that's fun if you need blood from 8. There.
You got that special rust blood?
She sure does.
I'll take some of that rust blood.
Really I'll take some iron. Rust blood.
You're going to have to do that on your turn and mark blood, and you're going to have to search for it.
Rust blood sounds like the failed Axe body spray that I needed in high school.
9 successes total. So I'm going to mark down their 6. And what's their threat rating again?
Their threat rating is an 8. So you have 3 successes remaining. You have 9 successes. They were 6, so that gives you 3 to play with. You have navigate fairgrounds 10 and find the blue carousel, or you have threat 8.
Okay, I'm going to... So I negate 6 of their... Actually, no.
They've rolled 6 successes on their attack, so you have...
negate 4 of them.
And take 2 injury.
And then do 5 damage to the... 4 damage to them and drink some blood out of the Rust Witch.
Okay. Great. I would say the Rust Witch is pretty far away. You are not going to be able to do all that in one turn. You're not going to be able to make it all the way over there to drink Rust Witch. You could drink some tank crew here, but you can't drink Rust Witch.
I'm going to drink Rust Witch?
Nope.
Fine, I'll just do 5 damage to them.
Okay, great. So their threat is down.
I can't drink Rust Witch.
Rust Witch.
We have Rust Witch at home.
And you're going to take 2 injury?
I will take 2 injury, yeah.
Okay, so roll up your injuries. You're going to roll 2d6 or 1d6
first. That is a 2.
Yeah, what happens to you there?
My suit is torn. How dare they?
How dare they?
As the bullet passes through my suit, I scream like it is the most grievous injury. I'm like, no! This suit is irreplaceable, darlings.
Hearing the death throes...
Yes, the death throes of the suit, and you do take 1 more injury.
Yep.
Hearing the the absolute death throes of Iryna, Flint flies into a rage, both figuratively and literally.
Amazing. I just want to hear what Irina's last injury is, and then please tell me about the rage.
No one's going to be happy with me because it's a three, and I'm going to, of the 3 to 4 category, I'm going to choose hair ruined as another bullet whizzes past, and my hair gets ruffled, and again, I'm like,
Incredible. Go ahead, Flint. My apologies. Go ahead.
Okay. I'm gonna go a little liberal with this.
Please. Everyone else, go ahead.
So you mentioned that there were planes falling out of the sky. I'm gonna take full advantage of this.
Yeah.
Flint takes wing, flying into the air towards one of these aircraft.
Okay.
Heading straight to the front of it as it is descending down at Flint.
Yeah.
It strikes his body and Flint explodes into this shower of blood and gore. He is literally liquefied as he hits the windshield like a freaking bug on the front of this on the front of this plane.
Is this your new advance?
Yes, it is.
Oh my god!
As the pilots are kind of like frantically trying to get rid of the gore that's on the windshield, you watch as these drips of blood starts to pour in from the cracks, the crevices and the seams inside the cockpit and reform, and Flint is now inside the pilot's cockpit. There is just this shaking, this thrashing, this explosion of blood as I use my steel gouging claws to rip them to shreds. Yes. And as one of the bodies collides and impales themselves on the actual steering pilot's joystick thing, it re-angles the entire plane and drops it directly onto the tank and the crew that is there. I wish to use a mark of blood for my ooze form, mark of blood for my aerial combat, mark of blood for my improved projectile for aerodynamics.
You're throwing a plane into a tank crew. You're absolutely doing those things. Yes, you are.
Yeah, and of course, with a brawl, I'm going to be dropping that on top of them as well. So that is quite a glorious amount of stuff. And if they're not expecting it, I mean, could I petition for an ambush with a plane?
I would say yes, they're not expecting a plane to fall out of the sky on top of them. I'm going to roll their 3 attack. yep, I'm going to do that. Nice. But yes, you absolutely drop a plane on them out of the sky.
Oh my god.
So that's just 2 successes for them. So you're going to have to overcome those 2 successes before you do anything, but I'm sure you're going to be just fine.
Oh,
with your 46 D6.
Well, it's 8 D6. It's not quite as dramatic, but that is 2, 4, 5, 6, 7 successes.
Incredible. Fuck, yeah. So you have 5 successes left. You absolutely squash this tank crew. Like the plane just, it flattens. The tank is destroyed. The people are crushed. The Nazis are crushed underneath it with one of their own planes. So that seems quite poetic. So you have completely obliterated the threat. You now have Navigate Fairgrounds and the Blue Carousel 10. So you can take 2 of the last of your successes and allocate them towards that, dropping it down to an 8. So the rest of you will have to navigate those. Yeah, go ahead.
Could I feed on the pilot crew with one of my actions?
Absolutely, you could. So you would it would only be 9 left on the fairgrounds, but yes, you can feed on the pilot crew.
And in addition, when I do that, Flint is also quite ravenous, meaning that as a melee attack, I can gain 3 blood from the one action.
Hell yeah, you do so. Fantastic. All right.
Oh, and you know what? With one last thing, mm-hmm. I'm also going to regenerate my injury with those 3 that I've just acquired.
Go for it. That sounds incredible. Great. Okay. Because, yes, you still have 1 more injury remaining, don't you?
Nope. That's it.
Nope. That clears your injuries. Fantastic. Okay. So we've still got, if you do not clear the Navigate Fairgrounds, reinforcements will show up by the end of the round.
Okay.
And you'll probably get another tank rolling through, is what you will likely face come up against. Okay. So who is next?
I think it might just be Cosgrave. So there's no more bad guys.
No more bad guys. You just have to get yourself through the fairground.
We just have to find our way through. Okay.
You have to find the blue carousel.
So it's 9 things that Cosgrave has to clear in this.
Yeah. And who is left to go?
It's Cosgrave.
Okay, great. So if Cosgrave does not clear 9 at the end of this, there would be another tank that shows up. I believe. Yes.
Cosgrave is going to take out the Babylon candles.
Yeah.
That he got all 6 of them, and he thinks to himself, I've got to clear a lot of ground really fast.
Yeah.
And he's going to put them, stick them in his mouth like a series of cigarettes, and he's just going to light them one at a time as he's just going to jumper his way.
Are you lighting all 6 Babylon candles?
No, not at the same time, and hopefully that's enough for God.
1, 2, 3, 4.
If you light more than 3 of them in like a close succession, like you will have to succeed on the terrify roll, and if you fail the terrify roll, you will get like part of your body will be shunted elsewhere,
sent to the shadow realm. I see.
Yeah, you will have to answer.
Here's the thing: if part of your body is in the shadow realm, that might make you, that might put you over the edge of second best necromancer.
you might jump over Bishop for London's second best necromancer.
Hey. Who lives forever? Us. So here's what I'm going to do.
Okay.
I'm going to take, I'm going to really quick, as I'm like lighting up 4 of the, wait, does it get harder if I do all 6?
Yes.
Fuck. Can Cosgrave do a bump of Shark's cocaine?
The 2 bumps have already burned on.
Oh, sadness.
We'll just light 4. We'll just get a little dangerous.
Okay.
You know? We'll light 4. I'm going to, just shotgun one of these glass jars of blood that I've collected.
Yes.
Crunch.
You still taste the bleach, the petrol, and the pine tar.
Oh, this is a terrible vintage.
It's gross.
And I'm going to wake up one of these dead tank operators.
You absolutely are.
One of the ones that just has his arms. I mean, no arms, just legs.
Yep.
And I say, run around, find a carousel. And I'm just going to start lighting these puppies up. So okay. we've got Dance Macabre and 4
Wait,
Babylon.
Wait, I have a question.
Yeah.
Is the danger only to the person lighting the candles?
Yes.
Just saying, you could get a corpse with arms and give him a lighter too.
Oh.
No, I hadn't thought of that myself. I love that idea. Cosgrave isn't as smart as
just
Adam.
Just a little teleporting zombie.
1, 2, 3, 4.
Mechanically, the Babylon candles will send you 50 feet per candle.
Uh-huh.
And if you the terrify roll that you're looking to beat here is 2 successes. If you do not get 2 successes, that your body will be partly shunted elsewhere in an opposite direction, and you will be stuck in something. You will be like stuck in part of a building.
I've only got a terrify of 2. This is going to go.
I believe in you.
I believe.
It was a 2 and a 6.
Yeah.
Well done.
Let's go.
Okay, so you can go, if you've lit 4 Babylon candles, you can go up to 200 feet. Where would you like to go?
Well, I want to jump 50 yards at a time. I want to go.
Yeah.
Okay. And I assume each of those give me an extra die on this roll.
They sure do.
Great. And I got fucking Heinrich over here running in the opposite direction.
Heinrich. So
I guess this is a search
roll. It was
Hans
last time, Heinrich. Yes, it will be a search roll. Yes.
Gosh, I wish I were better at searching.
Yeah, your search is not.
It was all on you, bud. Otherwise, another tank is absolutely going to roll in.
Yeah, this is
going
to be fine. We've got.
Here's the thing. Another tank just means fresh blood, baby.
Yeah, baby. I need some
okay.
And I would say the Rust Witch has, I would say, 4. We're going to go that Ubermensches have 4 blood servings in them. Special tasting blood.
We only got 4 successes.
Okay.
Good. That's good.
Do you get bonuses for their blood, or do they just taste different?
You don't know yet.
They're just built different.
Perhaps you could ask somebody at Checkpoint Bravo when you get in there.
Oh boy.
Right. I mean, Cosgrave has been down in this this machine man blood pretty aggressively.
Nothing crazy happened to me just
so
now.
Just got a little gear out of his neck now.
Start popping around with these candles. Like the second the candle, it just kind of burns down and you're just pop, 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 pop. And you start searching through. You see multiple different carousels. You see multiple different rides, but none of them the right shade of Fang blue. Heinrich starts running around. You've given him the objective to search for blue, and it is not quite enough. As you hear the roll of another tank roll through, this is actually a fully operational tank, not the broken one. So we have a challenge rating of 2. on this tank. This is a very, very difficult tank. Threat rating 8, attack rating 6, and a challenge of 2.
Oh boy.
Sorry, can you give me those numbers again?
Threat rating 8.
Yeah.
Attack 6, challenge 2.
What does challenge mean?
Challenge means you have to spend 2 dice to actually hit 1 threat.
Ooh.
He's a big tank.
Is it? Wait, sorry. So to clarify, if you get 6 successes,
yes,
you spend 2 of those and then you reduce it by 4, or is
yes.
it? Oh, it's not. So it's not 2-1. It reduces your successes by 2.
Yes.
Okay. I was very unsure about that.
Essentially, it's like confused. A damage threshold. You have to overcome the damage threshold.
You have to
first.
Do 3 or more in yes. order to do enemy. Okay, great.
Yes. And the attack is 6. So you still have navigate fairgrounds and find the carousel 5. And now your tank comes in. So we are essentially at the top of the round. And reinforcements just keep coming unless you clear them. So let's go, guys. Who's up?
All right. Well, now that the Rust Witch is gone, is my car working again?
You could run back and go get it.
I'm going to go get back my stunt wagon.
The bazooka car?
bazooka car.
Go get your anti-tank car. Do that.
Yeah, I'm going to go get my anti-tank car.
I was like, that's a good idea.
I'm actually going to use it to see if I can find the Ferris wheel.
Okay, you're going to zip around to see if you can find the Ferris wheel?
Zip around if I can find the Ferris wheel.
Yeah, go for it.
Is that a fix?
That would be to driving. Find the Ferris wheel. That would be this is a search.
A search,
because it's not like you're just driving. You're actually attempting to search.
We are in a fairground. Are there any like cool ramps or anything?
Can I ramp it on anything?
I would say this isn't a skate park, so no.
It's too bad,
dude. These Germans make the shittest theme park.
Yeah, they don't put
no ramps
fucking,
to ride
no
my car
I
off.
I am going
to
say
fuck?
That the car is going to the tank is going to fire at you as you are running through. So I am going to roll my 6 attack dice as you.
If I go to Disneyland and can't do vehicular stunts,
well, you're lucky because I only have 3 successes that you can clear.
Yeah, well, I only rolled 2 for search.
I've got a back pocket hex. I would like to, as I'm desperately searching around this thing, I would love to mark my 1 special to reduce a threat's attack rating by 1. So I would just love to like send a curse going straight down the barrel of the tank to like fuck with the gunner's vision.
Okay, incredible. You do so. So you see as this gunner starts to fire off of the tank, you see at the last minute it moves to the side and it narrowly avoids missing Chuck as you have essentially helped him parry this round rather than causing him some big old damage.
I rolled 2 successes.
Okay, so they rolled 3 successes, attack rating by, I just basically took 1 of those dice away for you. So that's the parry there
all
for
right.
you there.
Okay. So I dodge it.
You do dodge it.
In my non-dodge sports wagon.
Absolutely. Okay.
Yeah, that's my turn.
Who's next?
Enraged by my grievous injuries, as the car drives past, I'm gonna jump on the roof.
Yeah,
and the bazooka is attached to the roof of this car.
Yes,
cool. I'm gonna like sit on top of it and move it around. I'm gonna shoot at this tank with this fucking bazooka.
Yeah, absolutely, do that.
Sick. What was it against armor?
Let me find your anti-tank bazooka.
I'm gonna also throw an explosive rune at these idiots.
Absolutely.
Fuck it.
Do
Let's
that.
Get crazy.
Go off.
You have one use of the microwave array mountable bazooka turret, and it is a +3 to anti-tank.
Shit, yeah.
So it's a +4 dice, technically.
Yep.
Nicole, don't forget. Nice. Have you used your proton blaster?
I have, but luckily I'm on it. I have a special to get use of it again.
Oh, yeah.
Don't worry.
Fuck yeah, dude. And I'm going to mark another blood to have those bats get real nasty with it.
Sounds good. I'm going
to
roll my attack rating of 6.
Yep,
or is it now my attack level 5 because of bat pocket hex, correct?
I think it was just for that 1 attack.
It says reduce the attack rating.
Oh yeah, then there you go.
So I'm now at an attack rating 5. Nice work.
Thank you. That's the thing. That's that, and that's the bats. Them bats getting nasty on it.
I've got 2 successes. You'll have to clear on top of that. Okay. Plus the tank's challenge rating of 2.
Ooh, there are of my dice. 3 of them were failures, but the others are good. 2 okay. sixes, 2 fives, and 2 fours. All real categoried out. 4, 6, 8 successes.
Okay, so you're going to essentially have to clear 4 of those to do any damage to the tank at all.
So how much damage did they do? 2 on me?
Yes.
Cool. I'm going to reduce those 2.
Yeah.
And then I'm going to spend 6. I'm just going to straight up spend 6 on them, meaning it does 4 damage.
That is correct. So you see the bats absolutely swarm in over this tank. And as you fire the anti-tank bazooka, it just absolutely clears a shot straight through one of the front wheels.
And for the first time since dropping out of our coffins, I have 0 blood. Every time I've ever used blood, I got blood back. This is the first time I'm hitting. I'm just sitting on 0 right now.
Arena's getting hungry.
Oh, yeah. You can see a wild look in Arena's eyes as they are mourning their ruined hair and coat.
Okay, who's next?
I'm going to use my scavenger ability. So I roll a d6 to restore my weapon.
Yes.
I have a 4. So I guess that is that a success?
Yes, it is.
That's great. Okay, so I'm going to use my proton beam emitter, hopefully successfully this time. Point it at the tank.
Yes.
Where it.
Okay. I have 6.
Okay, you have 6 successes.
Yeah,
I'm going to roll the tank against you. So that is 5 against you. And I have 3 successes there. So you have 3 successes to play with. I rolled 5. Rolled 3 successes plus the 2, and you had 6. 5. So one of those successes, I think, can add, if my math is correct.
Or you can mark some wounds.
Isn't it 2 and 1?
I rolled 5 successes.
Oh, you rolled 5.
Mm-hmm. I had 5. Wait, no.
5 math. Attacks. 3 successes.
Thank you. It's late. My math is... So we've got 3
5 attacks,
there.
3 successes, and it's a challenge rating 2. So
there's 3 left.
You have to you have to remove 2 of those successes regardless. So
2 count for
and
1.
And you can either take 3 wounds or take any amount of up to 3 wounds.
That's correct.
But if you negate all 3 wounds, you get 1 success. Dude, numbers are hard.
Numbers are hard.
Especially at 11:30 at night.
What's it like getting in at 11:30 when it's 1:30
in
the morning?
I'll take 3 wounds.
Okay. Amazing, yeah. And you want to.
Fuck yeah, dude.
So it's just a graze for me. So it's just lightly sort of.
Okay, so you're gonna have to roll your d6 3 times. Yeah. So
Dag,
that's the first
Dag
one.
Dag here sitting at like what noon is it?
Yes, 3, no, it's 2 p.m. lunchtime.
Right?
Delicious.
Oh yeah,
yeah.
Okay, like that's a 1. Yeah.
So what's that injury do for you?
That's I'm dazed.
Okay, so you're dazed. You're kind of like this bazooka firing back kind of hits you in the shoulder. And it's grazed you. And you're feeling like a little like light in the head. And what's the last one? You have had 3 injuries onto you to basically clear down this all the way to. I think that'll clear the threat down to level 1.
I got a 6, so that's
if you get a 6, you choose one of those categories. You don't have to use the 6th one.
Amazing.
Yeah.
Just have a little, I'm already dazed. Can I be just a graze. That's great.
No, cause you rolled a 6. So it's either hand injury or you lose an arm.
So
it's
like,
those 2 that you can mark.
Okay. Then I'm going to have a hand injury, not lose an arm, please.
Okay. So you feel pain throughout your hand and you realize that there are 3 or 4 broken bones in this hand, which will probably impact your ability to shoot. But the tank only has a threat rating of 1 now, so whoever is next can go for it.
Remembering you still need to get 5 search done.
I think...
Oh, you want to go? You go.
Oh. I don't know. I think Flint has a good idea. I'm going to go up to the tank.
Yes.
Now, the tank itself has one of those like little spinny lid things.
Absolutely so, does, yes, because you've said so.
Brilliant! All right, Flint, yes, Flint basically moves around and maneuvers himself around the back of this this tank. He reaches down and tries to like wrench open the hatch, but it is naturally locked as it should be. But that's for humans and their human weak noodle-like arms, not a giant man bat. So Flint grabs onto it and wrenches this lid clean off. Yes. And as he does, he peers inside as he sees the tank crew. And you then watch as Flint, almost like a cat, starts to... And then he watches this cylinder.
Oh, yes.
Pops out of his mouth. And you watch as Flint just sort of grins with this tusky, vampiric maw as he shakes his claw, and you hear this tink as the cylinder drops into the chamber.
And you're going to use one of your echo grenades. Go for it.
I'm going to absolutely use one of these echo grenades.
If you're a tank operator, you have to wear a helmet.
I think the tank isn't just one helmet. It's just a big helmet. You know what I mean?
They're wearing helmet, but that means they're wearing a helmet inside a helmet. Then, so.
Mm-hmm. That's
true.
That's a helmet on a helmet.
It's just
there.
All helmets. So.
Oops, all helmets.
And it would reverberate inside of the tank itself too.
It sure would. I'm going to roll my attack 5 against you as they attempt to take fire on you and not get blown to smithereens, and. I have to take a picture of this and send this to our group chat because
what just happened?
Oh no!
Is it bad? Is it good?
Any successes? I rolled no successes for me. So what happens as you probably absolutely obliterate? I know rough night for my rolling. I hope it gets better next time. Rough night for me. What happens as you obliterate this tank crew?
Okay, so I rolled a 5. So as this cylinder leans down, sort of clinks down, you hear these two soldiers start arguing together, just trying to figure out what they're going to do. One of them reaches down and tries to grab onto this thing, while the other goes at the same time. They both bang their heads together simultaneously, sort of shaking their head. Eventually, the guy who's driving the tank reaches down, calls them both Dunkoffs, grabs onto it, and throws it up towards Flint. As it flies up, you hear them sort of breathe a sigh of relief for a fleeting moment until they hear soft panting, and they look up, and like the goodest boy, when someone throws something, he fetched it for him, and he has it in his mouth covered in drool and drops it back in before slamming the lid down. And it explodes literally just in front of them. And as it shakes and reverberates, these three soldiers don't move. They stand perfectly still. But their eyes and their ears just start to pour blood as literally their entire, their brain and their cerebral spinal fluids have just liquefied and is now pouring out of every orifice in their heads.
So good. I'm going to give you, because of that beautiful description, you can have a free blood for that, my dear. Don't even have to spend anything. You can have a free blood for that one. Okay, so...
Oh, I love that.
You just hear this, like, there's just silence from the tank as you just hear this... Flint having a wonderfully good time inside. So how many... You had 5 successes, you said?
I did.
Okay, great. So that clears... You've got 1, 2, 3, which clears the tank, and you can put another 2 of those towards the blue carousel. So as kind of Flint, the sound rings out, I think what it does is it shuts off a bunch of the carousels near you. This concussive blast kind of blows out the lights, and far in the distance, you see a cluster of carousels over. So if you start heading over there, you're pretty sure you're going to be able to find the blue carousel. Your navigate fairgrounds is down to 3. And I will say that there is 4 blood available over in Rust, which if you...
Blue carousel.
I'll start making noise over to Iryna with the empty tank.
You're wonderful, darling. Can I paint a little picture as the concussive blast passes through the fairgrounds? Mm-hmm. There's that tower of six carps, and none of them fall. they get hit with the wave. They just still stand perfectly standing.
It's perfect. So essentially, if you're on your way out of here afterwards, you could potentially start this tank.
Take it with you.
Because you've now cleared it out. There will be some blood and guts on the inside, but there is definitely a tank here.
It does have a real big hole in it.
It sure does. It sure does have a real big hole in it. So you can see what you...
Whatever, there's a spare tank nearby.
Yeah, spare
it'll
tank.
Be true.
We'll anyone, take them together. Before you run in the opposite direction, is anyone having any blood from Rustwitch?
I want them on.
Yes, I want blood from Rustwitch.
Oh, did we clear all five of the searches?
You did. No, there's still three searches left, but technically, like narratively, it's on the other side of the fairgrounds, and Rustwitch is over here. So if anyone's drinking,
I would like a Rustwitch blood.
I would like a Rustwitch.
So there are you know what? Fuck it. There's one for each of you. Yeah. You can each have a little bit of the Rustwitch. As you drink in the Rustwitch, her blood tastes so like nasty. Stinging metal, ooh, pop rocks, and tonic water.
Oh, I don't mind the first one. I hate the second one. The third one is delicious.
And you, okay, so someone will need to, in the last little bit of the order here, but who has left to go? Astrid and Cosgrave. Okay, so you both have an opportunity to clear three.
Three? Okay, we can do this.
Go for
we can
it. Do this.
Yeah. I have a dog shit search.
You have two more Babylon candles and a zombie, so that's you're our backup. You're our anchor.
You have two Babylon candles, yes, and a zombie with no arms following you.
So in terms
no,
of
he
like...
went on his own. It's not my turn. Go ahead.
In terms of taking blood, that's like something you can do with extra successes or sort of like out of turn order, right? Like that's how that
if
works.
I give you a free one, you can do it out of turn order. But if you'd like to do it actively as part of your turn, you have to designate a success to it.
I understand. Okay, cool. So I will, I'm going to blood hunt yet again because I think that is a good... good idea. It because I can track targets or search for things using my scent of smell, and I think that I'm going to sort of be like, I know what Fang places smell like, so
absolutely
probably,
you do.
There's probably a similar scent here, so I will mark one blood for that bad boy, and that gives me that. And I don't get the, because there's no one fleeing. So it's just
no, there is nobody fleeing. You have absolutely destroyed this fairgrounds. It's in ruins. There's no Nazi fun time to be had here. And the rest of
this fairground is sucked to begin with. No one's going to miss this fucking fairground.
She's been kind of wreaking havoc here for about a week. It's basically been her plaything. So
can you explain to me what spirit fetters are?
Yeah, great question. Spirit fetters. Let's look that up in your case thing here.
Because it just says. Plus animals? I don't know what that means. Like...
Oh, your spirit fetters would be like it is. I think it's like unleashing your primal spirit.
Ooh, okay.
And it would be a plus if you're attacking an animal. And yes, werewolves count as animals.
Gotcha. Okay. So everything within the parentheses is attached to whatever the
bonuses
condition
are.
Is. Yeah. Okay. All right, then. That's fine. So...
Roll me that search.
Yeah, I'm doing it. Okay, that is a 5 and a 6. So that's 3 successes.
Fantastic. So, Astrid, you stop for a moment, and you take a good whiff of the air, and it's then you kind of narrow your eyes, and your senses are so sharp. You see, as you did with the first one, you see the bright blue of the fang blue on this lights of this carousel, and you take off running. All six of you take off after Astrid, and it is finally quiet. The last of the entropic energy crackling off into the sky, the machinery, the noise, and the light of the fairground all stopping. You see the carousel, and it starts to move. Gently turns on, quietly. The horses around move slowly, slowly, slowly. And there is a coin slot in each one. As you sit atop a horse, what do you put in the coin slot? Gut response. What do you put in the coin slot?
I vomit out a grenade.
Yeah.
And I try to stick it in the coin slot.
Okay.
Babylon candle.
You shove a Babylon candle. Okay, you shove a grenade in the slot. Okay, what are the rest of you putting in there?
Put a bobby pin.
Incredible. Chest or Iryna?
Where the bullet has passed through my suit, there was like a really lovely golden button, and I pluck the button off. It's useless either way, and I place it.
Chuck or Astrid?
I think Chuck has what are they called? The little stringy things the cowboys wear around their necks.
Oh, like a bolo tie?
A bolo tie. Take the little fastener of the bolo tie off. Put that in the coin slot.
Okay. Astrid, what do you put in?
I think that Astrid, like, when harvesting from the Rust Witch, took one of, like, the fingers, probably?
Yeah,
something
absolutely.
Off of the hand. And is just sort of shoving that into the coin slot.
Incredible. So as you hear the clunk, 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 and then Flint's subsequent, like, of the grenade blowing up inside the slot, the machines start to whir faster. No longer under the control of Rustwitch. Each of your horses begin to move softly up and down, and you hear the song We Meet Again by Vera Lynn, one of the most prolific songs of the entire war. On the Allied side, at least.
I'm sorry, am I?
It's DMCA copied. You couldn't do it anyway.
Fuck, dude. I gotta call Vera up, you know?
I know.
I got contacts.
The horses slowly rotate around, and you start to hear gears and pistons begin to engage, and the platform begins to descend down as it rotates down through the fairground floor into what you assume to be Checkpoint Bravo. And that is where we are going to end our episode.
Amazing.
Yay.
Amazing.
Whoa. Okay.
I don't like the way you said assume.
What you assume to be Checkpoint Bravo.
No, no, no. No.
No, no,
what
no,
is
no.
Checkpoint? What is Checkpoint Bravo?
It's definitely Checkpoint Bravo.
It's definitely, potentially Checkpoint Bravo.
100% Checkpoint Bravo.
Over under. Thank you all so much for coming out tonight and watching the second episode of Eat the Reich. We have our first episode is up here on Twitch, and I will be releasing it over on YouTube probably tomorrow. So you can watch this one here on Twitch, and then that one will be up next week. And then next Wednesday, we are here for as the vamps, the voracious vampires, head through Sector 1 on their way towards the Eiffel Tower and Hitler's Zeppelin. So please come back Wednesday, September 27th at 8 p.m. Pacific Standard Time right here, twitch.tv/BlackwaterDnD. We are going to go raid someone great. So thank you so much to our guests. And I'm very excited for our finale. Fangs out, everyone, and have a wonderful night. Okay, bye.
Bye.
Good night, everyone. Bye.